dignitaries and esteemed guests to this magnanimous occasion of Justice V.R. Krishnaiyar Memorial Speech and Talk on Cross-Examination as held as part of Golden Jubilee celebrations of Government Law College, Kozhikode in association with PRTC Calicut. When darkness comes in, let us not condemn the dark. Rather, let us light a lamp to illuminate lives and be the light that helps others to see. Ladies and gentlemen, I now request Ms. Gopika to come over to the dais for the prayer, and I also request all of you to kindly raise for the same. Thank you.
അകമലിഞ്ഞു ഞങ്ങളെ പാലിക്ക ദേവാ, അഴലാകിനിക്ക് അങ്ങാനന്ദമേകി, സകല സൗഭാഗ്യങ്ങൾ ഏകേണം നിത്യം. അഖില ചരാചര രക്ഷകാദേവാ, അകമലിഞ്ഞു ഞങ്ങളെ പാലിക്ക ദേവാ, അയലാകിനിക്ക് അങ്ങാനന്ദമേകി, സകല
സൗഭാഗ്യങ്ങൾ. Now, marking the beginning of this great session, may I take the privilege of inviting respected Mr. Nawaz Jan A, former syndicate member, as well as the chairman of the organizing committee of this event, as well as an alumnus of Government Law College, Kozhikode, to kindly deliver the welcome address and welcome the gather. Over to you, sir.
അങ്ങനെ വിവരമില്ലാത്ത ക്ലോസ് പോണ്ട, ഇവിടെ ഓഡിയൻസ്
Today is a wonderful day, a very fortunate day, because we have two legal luminaries in front of you. Honorable Justice Devan Ramachandran sir and Advocate M. Ashokan sir. We are celebrating the Golden Jubilee of this college, having 50 years of unblemished record. In this context, we are also commemorating the Bhishmacharya of Judiciary, Justice V.R. Krishnaiyar, on this day. He was born in November 1915, and he left this world physically on 3rd December 2014. Justice Devan Ramachandran sir is the most apt and most suitable person to commemorate Justice
V.R. Krishnaiyar for multiple reasons. He is more than a grandson to Justice Krishnaiyar. I don't think there is any need of a formal introduction of Justice Devan Ramachandran sir to you,
because by virtue of the online judicial process, every layman is having access to the court proceedings. And when the
bench of Justice Ramachandran is formed,
there will be hundreds of people, litigants, clients, counsels, they were all ready online. Recently something happened, I was also there. An old lady of 85 years of age came to serve with the folding hands,
and sir called her Amma, please don't do that. He kept away all other matters for the
time being, and attended very patiently and resolved the issue of that old woman, that infirm woman who has been running from pillar to post for the last 2 decades. A thing that could not be resolved for 2 decades could be
resolved within 2 minutes.
That is the speed with which the expeditious disposal of matters in the High Court of Kerala takes place these days. We have today the presence of Justice Devan Ramachandran sir to bless us with his enlightened talk on
various legal matters and remembering Justice V.R. Krishna. For me or for Justice Devan Ramachandran sir,
we don't require a particular day to remember the great Justice V.R. Krishna here, because he has always been kept very close to our heart, and we still believe that his presence is somewhere around this cosmos. You must all know that when a judge gets a matter in front of him, he applies his judicial mind to come to some conclusion, and he uses law as a tool. That being the general rule, what makes Justice Devan sir different from other judges is that his conscience speaks to him, and it doesn't move within the from the 4 boundaries of the Indian Constitution. That is very particular when the justice is to be done to poor, needy, and oppressed. It's not easy for a person in this era to afford costly advocates to present their matter before the court. For such people, for such category of persons, here is a judge with a humane mind, with a humane approach, with all humility, as one among you. And another thing that I have noticed in Justice Devan sir is that though he is in the bench, he has been elevated to bench long ago, despite being the fact that he is a senior judge of the Kerala High Court, he always tells that I am part of the bar. What more conducive, healthy, and friendly relationship can exist between the bench and the bar? His Lordship always says, I am part of the bar, and he never allows any advocate or any counsel to pardon before him or to tender apologies before him. And he always took care to see that the interest of the counsel is always protected, whether it is for the respondent or whether it is for the petitioner. You look at anything, any recent judgments that His Lordship has delivered, it has got a human touch in that. My senior Advocate M. Ashokan sir is here. While talking, he will narrate more about Justice Devan sir. I am not prolonging. Being the chairman of the organizing committee and being the administrator of pre-recruitment training center with whom this law college is associating for the conduct of this function, Justice V.R. Krishnayyar was the chief patron of this function. On behalf of each one of you, on my personal behalf, I extend a warm welcome to Justice Devan Ramachandran sir and Director of PRTC, Captain Serena, to receive Justice Devan sir.
The second one, I got one.
Here is M. Ashokan sir, the Dean of Calicut Bar. If someone is asked to take the first five top lawyers of Kerala, Advocate M. Ashokan sir will find a prominent place in the first five. That is why he is known as Dean of the Bar, and being his junior is not allowing me to say anything about him, and that is one of his best qualities. Even if I do a better thing in the court and come to him, I will wait for his appreciation, but I will never get an appreciation. Instead, I will get admonishment. But later on, he will call me very lovingly towards him and will say, Nawaz, if I give you a token of appreciation, that will only spoil you. You have to bring out the best out of you, so I am not appreciating you. You have to improve a lot. So what I could learn from Ashokan sir is that, first, what I realized is that the great realization of my ignorance. After having left the college campus, I thought I had come to know something about law. But when I started practice under M. Ashokan sir, I came to know that I am nowhere. So that is a great realization, and that made me to start out of scratch. Today, he will be giving us a presentation on the art of cross-examination, which is the most important skill a lawyer should have. I would request Professor P.K. Anis sir to receive Advocate M. Ashokan sir. A hearty welcome to you, sir. As the insiders don't require any welcome, still, our father figure, the principal of this Government Law College, this esteemed institution, Professor C.V. Kumaran, sir, is presiding over this function today. As you know, he is known as now the last word in international law and the criminal law. Such a versatile genius whose mode of functioning is silence. He gets everything done. I have never seen him violent or aggressive. Such a simple, humble human being in his thoughts, words, and deeds. I extend a warm welcome, and I would request Grishma to give flower to C.V. Kumaran, sir. On behalf of all of you, I extend a hearty welcome. On the dais is Dr. N.L. Sajikumar, sir, who needs no introduction to the legal fraternity as well as the law students. Dr. N.L. Sajikumar, sir, is the winner of the Best Teachers Award for 3 years consecutively. And though he is now working in Government Law College, Trivandrum, he was here for several years, and I had the opportunity of having been his student and several others also. His only focus in his entire career to see that the students are delivered the best services and they are equipped in all ways, not only to pass the examination, to become useful citizens of India. I extend a warm welcome to Dr. N.L. Sajikumar, sir. Professor Vidyut Subramanian, sir, is a faculty in this college who is known for his dynamic nature, his way of talk, way of walk. Everything is so dynamic that he is living in the hearts of thousands of students. I extend a warm welcome to Vidyut Subramanian, sir. Formality warrants that someone on the dais has to be welcomed formally. The head of the pre-recruitment training center, Captain Serena Nawaz, who had the rare opportunity of working with Justice Devan Ramachandran sir in capacity of member of the Commission for the Rights and Welfare of Women and Children under the chairmanship of Justice V.R. Krishna Iyer. I extend a hearty welcome to Captain Serena. And your lordship may be knowing that today we are conducting an essay writing competition, legal essay writing competition. The subject was suggested by my senior. Four subjects were given and a lot was taken. There were 68 participants, contestants in the essay writing competition, and it is under evaluation now. The result will also be announced before conclusion of this program. Last year, we had conducted the commemoration ceremony of Justice V.R. Krishna Iyer under the auspices of PRTC, where about 14 judges, including Justice D.Y. Chandrachud, joined us online, and it was a wonderful program. And 4 years ago, in the town hall, the very same Justice Devan Ramachandran sir had come and he had given such a wonderful lecture, and that was conducted in the town hall, and that was attended by almost all the dignitaries in Calicut. So here I am not going to add anything more to speak of Justice Krishna Iyer, because I am too little a person to speak anything about such an ocean. I am simply a droplet of that ocean. I would extend my hearty welcome to all my teachers of this college, all the teachers of KMCT Law College, all the teachers of Marcus College, and all other colleges, students who have come from different colleges, Mr. Viswadhan Achari, who has come all the way from Trivandrum just to listen to the talks of these two legal luminaries. So at the same time, I also extend a warm welcome to all these media people, and also one who is airing this as a link, as a live program, the YouTube and Facebook. I would request all of you to make use of this wonderful and rare opportunity to see that you are enlightened. When you go home, you are not going with empty hand and empty soul. You are going with content, a lot of satisfaction, a lot of knowledge, which will help you guide throughout your life with your wisdom. With these words, I would request Professor C.V. Kumaran sir, the principal of this college, to kindly preside over this function. Thank you and Jai Hind.
Thank you so much for this absolutely wonderful words, sir. They were really heartwarming and highly affirming. We are extremely delighted to have with us respected Professor C.V. Kumaran, principal of Government College, Kolkata, who has kindly consented to deliver the presidential address for the day. Over to you, sir.
Good morning, all. Honorable Justice Devan Ramachandran, esteemed Advocate M. Ashwagan, Dr. N. L. Sajikumar, Sri Vidyut, Captain Sarina Nawaz Jan, other members of the faculty, members of the legal fraternity, teaching fraternity, students of this college, other colleges, GD ladies and gentlemen. It's a pride moment for the Government Law College Calicut to have hosted such a wonderful program. In the name of a giant in the legal profession who combined versatile qualities as a lawyer, representative of the people, minister, member of the law commission, judge, jurist, above all a world renowned humanist. Justice V.R. Krishnayyar has been a sense of enthusiasm and hope for millions of people in India. The ideals of the Constitution, especially those enshrined in the preamble, like justice, social, economic, and political, assumed prominence and importance in various judgments, all of which have become path-breaking so far as the legal field is concerned. The memory of Justice V.R. Krishnayyar is actually a source of inspiration for everyone who studies law, who reads a judgment of the Supreme Court, because through various judgments like Shamshar Singh, the judgment in Bangalore water supply and sewerage case versus Royappa, and many other cases have shown us how creative was his mind, how fearless was his personality, and how elevated was his thoughts all over his career or throughout his career. As a student and a teacher, I had occasion to read many of his judgments, and I was also amazed to see that Justice Krishnayyar, when combined with Justice Bhagavathi or Desai or other judges of 1970s or 1980s, created various judgments that showed that judges were not mere interpreters, but they are actually jurists who can create new laws. An example is Royappa judgment. Similarly, his judgments for the poor, downtrodden, and the under-trial prisoners, like the judgment in Prem Shankar versus Delhi administration, and many other judgments, are lessons for the judiciary itself. A program to commemorate his memory is very important for us, all of us, on that particular aspect itself. And that is how we have cooperated with the PRTC for celebrating or commemorating his memory, and have actually organized a competition to the law students of all the colleges. And we are actually pleased to see that the large number of participation from almost all law colleges in Kerala. And this program is blessed with a speech by none other than Justice Devan Ramachandran, who doesn't need any kind of introduction from me. And we also have a very illuminating lecture on the art of cross-examination by an eminent lawyer of Kerala, Advocate M. Ashokan. And we think that this will be a golden opportunity for the budding lawyers and the law students of Kerala, and those who are watching us on YouTube live streaming and other media, that they will all appreciate this particular venture. So with this few words, I, on behalf of all of you and on behalf of my colleagues, invite most humbly Justice Devan Ramachandran to deliver the Justice V.R. Krishnayyar Memorial Lecture. Please, sir.
Thank you so much for everything that you have also written, sir. It really means a lot to us. No one chance without a formal Ladies and gentlemen, we are profusely honored to take this opportunity to welcome our respected Chief Guest of the Day, Honorable Mr. Justice Devan Ramachandran, respected Judge High Court of Kerala, who has blessed this august gathering with his gracious presence here today. Sir, we feel extremely honored to have you here with us today, and we welcome you all to the dais for the inaugural address.
It's still morning, so good morning. That takes me back to school. Good morning, sir. Thank you for having me today. Great honor, especially on the golden jubilee of a great institution. This is my first ever time to the Calicut Government Law College. First ever time. When I was a student, I think I have visited almost all the colleges, but I do not know why I never visited the Calicut Law College. Perhaps God willed that I visited for a special occasion like the 50th year of commemoration. The law colleges have changed from the time when we were there. I was in law college from 85 to 90. Students never took very kindly to guests. I don't think any guests would get away without a boo. But thank you for not doing that to me. It's a great, great audience that I see here. Wonderful set of students. I can see a very bright future for our country. You should be clapping. I spoke about you. This visit has also been very precious to me for some of the other reasons which I'll just tell you. I'm meeting Vidyut KS, your assistant professor, I think about 15 or 16 years later. He was associated with me as a lawyer till 2006. When all the other staff were being introduced, I heard that sound, similar sound, saying I'm Vidyut, and I recognize him with the mask on. It's a greater pleasure that I can see Veda Vidyut, his daughter, whom I hope will be a lawyer and be a judge and the Chief Justice of India someday. Dr. Sajikumar, I met him a couple of weeks ago at Trivandrum. I was invited to speak at the Kerala University. What an honor that he said that he has just traveled all the way here. Just goes to prove that some people cannot take enough of torture. He heard me extensively 3 weeks ago, and he has got the guts to come back and hear me again. So thank you for that pleasure, Sajikumar. It's always a pleasure, it is always a great honor to be with the next generation of lawyers. You are perhaps not the next generation, you are the present generation of lawyers who are going to come in. It's a great feeling of elation. It's a great feeling of joy or excitement, actually, because you are the face of the judiciary next in the next maybe 25 years. So when I visit any law college, which I do when I'm peripherally invited, I don't have to be strongly invited, I take up any invitation to a law college. I said I went to the Kerala University also, because I get to see the next generation of students. I get to see how you think. Because every 25 years, a generation changes. A generation, as we normally see, is about 25 years. So you are definitely a different generation than we were, because we studied about 35 years ago. So you people think differently, I know that. Every generation thinks differently. But there is one thing that I want to tell you, which is something which I tell all the students. It's a rather shame that you could not see Justice Krishnayyar. Justice Krishnayyar lived up to 99 years. He had a very full life, lived like a king or an emperor, or if there is anything more than that, that. He was a man who could really inspire. This is something which I tell everybody. Whatever you see me today, whatever you see me, if you think it's bad or good or whatever, 90% is Justice Krishnayyar. 10% is my father, who was my guru. This is again an anecdote that I say every time. And one more thing that I wanted to point out. The last time I came and talked in Calicut was a month or two after I became a judge in 2016. Again, I spoke about Krishnayar, but in Malayalam. So people who have seen that video possibly will get a reminiscence of what I'm going to speak now, because I think I spoke extensively of Justice Krishnayar at that point of time. And I was very fresh into the bench. And I said that day that every judgment that came to me, of course, I was doing lesser judgments at that time. Today, I do about 55, 60 judgments, or possibly more a day. The speed is very high. So I used to say that whenever a complex case came to me at that point of time, even today, not much of a difference, though I don't find so much of time to think about an issue. The first thing that comes to me is how Justice Krishnayar would have dealt with it. And that gives you a completely different insight. That's why I said he's a man who could inspire. And what we really require is inspiration. Education is only half done if you don't have the inspiration. You need somebody to tell you what you are and where you should be going. Teachers are there for you, of course. Your seniors are there for you, of course. But there is a class of people who can always inspire. And Justice Krishnayar was the emperor of those people. My singular privilege that I was born to my father, who was his junior, and by default I became a sub-junior, or whatever you call it. I never worked with Justice Krishnayar as a lawyer. When he retired, I was not even a law student. When I called him Sami, when Sami retired, I was possibly doing my pre-degree. I was doing my ninth standard actually. Because he was one of those people who saw me when I was born in 1968. But he's a man who could really inspire. And this is what I tell in all my speeches about Krishnayar. For the last about 9 or 10 years of his life, about 8 to 9 years of his life, I was always spending 10 minutes a day in the evening with him, every evening, every evening. 8:30 was a time when I would get a call from his office. It would always be Sami at the end and asking me, why are you not coming? So eventually it became a kind of a routine for me. And I remember 4th of December he died. 5th or 6th of December, sheer routine, I got up to walk to his residence without thinking that he's no longer with us physically. It was a great loss. But today I always say that I'm always inspired so much that I think he's with me, he can decide, I can possibly feel him and talk to him, just as I do to my father also. So the last 8 years, those precious moments that I had changed everything. And I'll tell you one thing, we never talked about law. If I have the time, I'll come back to that. I'll tell you why lawyers should be not really always reading law. So we would be talking about everything in the world. He brought me to the world of Vivekananda, Rabindranath Tagore, Cicero, all the European jurists, and not in the context of law, in the context of philosophy. How life is and what really life is. This is very important for a lawyer, because you're all budding lawyers, you're all in the threshold of a wonderful profession, a very breezy, a very exciting profession. Take it from me. Of course, slightly uncertain, and some people may have a problem with that. But then the uncertainty is what makes the profession of law very, very special. So when you are on the threshold of a profession which can take you anywhere, you can be the Chief Justice of India and down, whatever you want to be. It's all the way you dream about it, and of course a little bit of play of destiny. You must understand that your responsibility is also very, very high. This is something which I speak more or less in all my speeches also, when we talk about lawyers and jurists, that Constitution is our ultimate law. I'm sure you're all reading the Constitution, you're all studying the Constitution. But I'm not sure if many of you understand what really the Constitution is. In fact, I had the opportunity to speak at the Kerala University about the Constituent Debates Assembly. The Constituent Assembly debates is the root of the Constitution. It tells you how our forefathers thought about and envisioned our nation. I can't speak of the Constituent Assembly debates today, but I'll tell you about the Constitution. So the Constitution, if you're studying the Constitution, please understand what Constitution is next time you'll see it. It is the ultimate law in India. Constitution is not merely a document, it is a law. It's the ultimate law, what is known as a grand norm. Grand norm means the ultimate law, the suprema lex. And Professor Hart, H.L.A. Hart, you would possibly be reading him in your studies. He said that the Constitution is the ultimate law to which every other law has to conform. And that's the beauty of the Constitution. There is no law beyond the Constitution. You have to live with the Constitution. And if you want to really know the Constitution, please read the preamble. It's a short paragraph, but really gives you a distilled version of the entire Constitution, which is a large organic document. The Constitution is not something that is stillborn or not living. It is a living document, an organic document. It has had, it's gone through 104 or 105 amendments. That's not because it is weak. It is because it is the most strongest in the world. This is the Constitution that has survived 70 years. Not many constitutions in the world have survived even 7 years. So we have survived 70 years. It will possibly survive for the next 70 or more than that without any change, except the amendments that will be brought in because of the change of the times. So when we talk about the Constitution, please understand the concepts of justice, liberty, equality. This is what the lawyers are, the sentinel on the key we, when we speak about them in such terms. You are all privileged members of the society. I don't say this. This is a preamble to your code of ethics which say this. It starts by saying that a lawyer is a privileged member of a society. And they say what is right for a person who is not a lawyer may sometimes be wrong for a lawyer. So that's the kind of responsibility that you have. I'm not sure if you have read the preamble to the your code of ethics. Please read the code of ethics and the preamble. So this is the importance of being a lawyer. I don't know whether the law students would really appreciate it at this stage. Maybe when I was hearing a speech of this kind when I was in college, I would be as interested or disinterested as most of you are. But the point is that these are the things that will possibly grow on you as you grow older. You understand the importance of being a lawyer as you be in the profession. I've written a judgment, a few months after I became a judge in 2016, that according to me, the true import of a law student is to be a lawyer, to be an advocate, a practicing advocate. Of course, there are students who are good enough, brilliant enough to join the judiciary straight away. You don't have to wait for the threshold practice these days. You can join the judiciary, it's as good. And I think you should. Most of you should try the judiciary. It's a wonderful feeling. But then if those of you who really want an adventurous life, an extraordinarily experience as you go forward, take the profession of law as an advocate. No doubt it is uncertain because you have no idea where the profession is going to take you in a few years. But then commitment, perseverance, and conscientiousness will certainly take you where Mr. Ashokan is here today. I practiced for 25 and a half years. I was elevated only in the year 1996. And I can say that with full sincerity even now. I miss my lawyering days so much that I can't describe it to you. But I make it up by being one of the most garrulous and talkative judge on the bench. Now we are having a hybrid kind of a court where you can see me on the video also, online video. Some people may be surprised, what is this chap doing? I speak all the time. Yes, I do. Two reasons. One, the numbers are very high. I have to keep moving quickly. I have to go with the case a minute and a half or so, roughly. And that takes in the argument and the dictation of a judgment. And the second is that I love my profession of law so much that I have not lost the urge to argue. So I'm a very argumentative judge. I argue with a lawyer. And sometimes lawyers feel, are we talking to a judge or to a contesting lawyer? But that is the way I am. That is because I was brought up in the profession. And it's something which I've never lost a passion about. So being a lawyer, being an advocate, it's not a lawyer alone, being an advocate is something that you have to prepare yourself. I'm not sure if you've heard this. They say that law is a very jealous mistress, which cannot be. This is a famous Justice Blackstone quotation. Law is a very jealous mistress. It is not something to be won by trifling favors, but by constant attention. Very true of a real advocate. The moment you step in as an advocate onto the rolls of the bar, your life starts, which will last for the rest of your lifetime. You have to be committed. You have to be conscientious continuously. But that doesn't mean that you can't have fun. Please have your fun. All the news that you hear about lawyers working 24 hours are all wrong. We never work 24 hours. Work for the time that you are expected to do, have your fun, but then take your work very seriously. You don't have to take yourself very seriously. This is one motto that I follow as a judge. I try not to take myself seriously, but my work is very serious to me. It's the same with a lawyer. But the best thing about being a lawyer is that you are in charge of somebody else's life. This is not something that others can talk about. When somebody comes to you with a problem, with a small case, when you start off your profession, you get small cases, as they call it, but no case is small. Because everybody who comes to you, whoever be the client, whatever be the cause, whatever be the dimension of the problem that he faces, he has a genuine issue. So when you meet somebody and they tell you that I have a problem, I want to file a case, or I want an advice, please understand that he's coming to you as a last resort. As I always say, a client doesn't walk into a lawyer's office to see him. It is a last resort. Even he may go to a doctor, but never to a lawyer. Generally, lawyers are never taken that lightly. So when he comes to you, understand that somebody is there with a problem, and it is your skill which takes them along. Now, I said a lawyer or an advocate, a great advocate is not somebody who studies the law alone. A great advocate is someone who has a vision of the world. It requires a lot of reading, a complete encyclopedic reading of anything that you can put your hands on. Because a lawyer, in its ultimate analysis, what do? You present your case to a judge or a presiding officer, and you make them understand. You have to be a good storyteller. You have to be a good raconteur. You have to know the pulse of the person who is hearing you. You must understand what he is, and what he can understand, what he can imbibe. Because however good you have prepared yourself, you will win your case only if the judge understands what you want to convey to him. So you may be the best, you may have done every kind of research and homework in the night. You may have burned the midnight oil, as they say. But when you go to a court and meet the judge, it really depends on how you can convince him. You have to be a great storyteller. You require a vision of life. You require a vision of the world. Reading is very, very important, general reading. I'm not talking about any specific topics that I'm referring to. It could be anything that you want, anything that you can read on, because reading can also help you develop language. And language, I don't know if you've read Denning's famous quote, language is the tool of the lawyer. It's the only tool that will take you forward. When I address a next generation, as I said, youngsters like you, I'm aware that you are in the threshold of a profession in a completely different world. It was much easier for us, I believe, because in 1991, all that we had to do was to come to the court, argue, make your point, walk away, get your case done. But today the world is very different. Even I did not believe myself, I would not have believed myself when I was told, if I had been told in March last year, that a day would come when I would be hearing cases on a computer, when I would be speaking and talking to a computer instead of a lawyer in his physical form. But then we did that for the last 1.5 years. So things are changing, the techniques are changing. The information is all within your grip now, unlike the old research, which Mr. Ashokan will possibly tell you. We were all trained to do research with physical books. It was not very easy. We did not have the computer systems that you see today. We did not have the software. We had digests where we would have to look through each topic and then find out the case that we wanted. But today that's all easy. You just have to put some search words into the in the dialect box, and then you get the judgments that you want. So it's an age of information technology that you are entering now. This is very, very important. Because please understand, a client does not really require a lawyer anymore to understand the law. This is very, very important. We could get away with anything we talked to the client in the early 90s, because they had no option of understanding what is true and what is not. But today they have a problem, they have to go to the internet, search it, they get the problem, they get the answer. So if you look at the traditional attributes of a lawyer who advises a client based on the information and the knowledge he has, that has now changed. There is a paradigm shift, because today the computers have taken that over. So therefore, some people may be encouraged to say that you may not have lawyers tomorrow, it will be only computers. Not really. This is where your generation will have a different alignment in life. It's the skills that you now develop at the school, at the college, as also with your seniors, that will now take you steadfast in future. Because it's the way you operate the law. It is not the law which is now important. It is the way you operate it. It is the way you deal with it. Now, it's the same law that all of us are dealing with. You will see that some of them are extremely successful, some are not. Why? Because it's the way you deal with it. It's the way you, you know, operate the law, which is now important. Those are the skills that you require. The syllogistic skills, which is to mean the way you deal with the permutations and combinations of a set of facts. I'm sure many of you have done moot courts. And this is something which I tell when I attend moot courts also. When you get a problem, be that in a moot court or in a real life, read it not once, read it several times. Every time you read it, you will see that you are getting a different concept altogether. The permutations and combinations of the same set of problems leading to the solution that you can get are so numerous, and the way you maneuver the law to get where you have to, you'll be surprised by the possibilities, these endless possibilities, for which you have to apply your mind, read the problem, understand the situation, understand the complexity of the nuances of the aspects that are brought to your notice, and you will be surprised. Every time you think about it, you will have a different way of approaching it. And this is where a lawyer becomes a good lawyer. An advocate is an advocate, but a good advocate is one who understands how the nuances of law will have to be operated and how you get the ultimate result. Because eventually, the client is only interested in result. There is no loyalty to a lawyer unless you get the results done. So it's the way you deal with the problem of your client and how you deal with it with the nuances that you are presented, which really makes you a good lawyer. So keep this in mind. Study the problem. Think about the permutations that you can arrive at. Something which is not very easy to talk about in an abstract manner. When you get an issue, when somebody comes and tells you, "Sir or madam, I have a problem like this. I want a solution." You see, there are several solutions. And this most conducive to your client, which is a solution, that is the work of a lawyer. Because a computer will tell you one set of permutations, generally. When you type in, is it 1 plus 1 is 2? That's what the computer will always tell you. But for a lawyer, sometimes 1 plus 1 can also be 11. So this is the way that you have to develop yourself. Research and the way you think. And for this, a reading on a global platform is very, very important. Reputation is very, 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 very delicate. See, after all, a lawyer, when you talk about a lawyer, you say, now Mr. Nawazjan was saying the best 5 lawyers in Kerala, he is one of them. That's pure reputation. Who decides who is the best lawyer? It is a reputation that you garner. You know, it's a slow-cooked reputation. It's not something that you gather today. You join the profession today, you're all seeing us after 25, 30 years of where we are. I have put in 31 years at the bar today, or at the bench and bar today, to stand in front of you and speak like this. I couldn't have done this in the year 1991. It's a process of continuous evolution and continuous improvement. I am certainly a better law advocate today than I was in 1991. And it's the same way every day that I spend at the bar. So this is the beauty of the profession. This is the beauty of the avocation. And I said there is also a collateral or an axiomatic turn now. You can always be judicial officers. It's also equally important and equally wonderful. It gives you a purpose in life. Somebody asked me, why did you join the bench? My answer was very simple. I have found meaning to my life today. I used to work for myself. I used to be more concerned about my family, making money, making reputation, things like that. But today it's not so. Today I find meaning, a different meaning to my life. When I can do something for an ordinary client who has been languishing without their case being taken up, it's something, it's a feeling of divinity. So that's the beauty of the bench. So the bar and the bench are equal. That's why when Nawaz said, it's right, I have never thought that the bar is inferior to the bench or the bench is superior to the bar. We are equal partners. We work in tandem. And as I've said in my inaugural speech when I joined as a judge, I said, judgments are made more by the bar than the bench, because it is the contribution we get them from the advocates which really makes our judgments better. And I'll tell you a small anecdote. I asked Justice Krishna Iyer about the Indira Gandhi order. See, it is one interim order which became far more famous than the final judgment. Not many people understand or remember the final judgment in the Indira Gandhi case. But everybody talks about the interim order which Justice Krishna Iyer gave. So I asked him in one of our interludes in the evening, as I was saying earlier. He said that judgment is the product of Nani Palkiwala on the one side and Soli Sarabji on the other side. the two greatest doyens of the Indian profession, legal profession. So this is the support that the law, the bench gets from the bar. And we can do better when the lawyers are well prepared and you are really good. And that must be your aspiration in life, to do better, to add value to yourself, to better your reputation. Because as I was saying, reputation is not something that you can create in one day. It's something that you may have to develop maybe in 10 years or 15 years or 20 years. But then that reputation, as I call it, the slow-cooked reputation, stands with you. And that is what will take you forward in your quest in greater heights of life. In fact, when I started this, lecture or boredom or whatever you call this, I did not have a topic. So I am just putting it to you, if there is anything that you want me to speak on, any one of you can tell me, if you are interested. I'm not prepared, but then I can possibly respond the way I can, if you are interested. Because I did not have a topic to start with. Nawaz did not tell me what my topic was. He said, you speak on anything that comes to your mind. Seeing the new generation, this is what I thought. Then, pardon me if I really tortured you, but then I thought these are small things which we learned when we were in the first initial years of our life as advocates. So if there is anything that you think I am capable of speaking about, I can try that, if anybody wants to. Or I'll stop this and I can let you take the next enlightening session of Advocate Ashokan.
How the new entrants should conduct themselves.
That is what I was saying. In fact, the new entrants. Good. Something which I missed out when I was speaking. One thing I will tell you when you join the bar. A judge reads you with the confidence that you exudes. Keep this in mind. I know whether your case is bad or good with your body language. If you come to me with the confidence that I can visibly see, I certainly will get the impression that you are now handling a good case. But you come to me with a body language which is beaten down and which doesn't exude that kind of confidence, I immediately get the inference that, look, your case is bad, and then I move in on those tracks. But then how do you become confident? You become confident by being ready with the facts. When you know the facts as a story, because when you come to the court, you are the proxy for your client. I don't know if you have seen the courts. How many of you have really seen the courts? Have you seen courts? When you see the courts, you will see lawyers saying, my husband, a man would stand up and say, my lord, my husband did this to me. That's because he's speaking for his client. The client is a wife. So you become the client. You step into the shoes of the client. Their gender is not important. I say that, look, my lord, my wife, my husband killed me. My husband is beating me. This is me speaking. You see, I'm a man and I'm saying that my husband, it is not the new kind of things that we talk about. Not that at all. It's just that I come into the shoes of the client. And when you come into the shoes of the client, you must be the client. Just as the client knows the facts as his or her life, you have to learn it in such manner that it becomes part of your life. For you, it must be second nature to make that submission about the facts, as if you are speaking from your own experience of your own life. And when you get prepared to that extent, the confidence that a judge will get becomes unmistakable. So keep this in mind when you enter the bar. When you enter the bar, make sure that you understand the facts correctly. I am one of those judges before whom I get the honor of a large number of young lawyers coming in. You see my court, I sit at 5A, it's on the net also. You'll see a large number of young lawyers coming in. Some of them are really prepared, some of them are not. And one thing I tell all of them is, please study the facts. Some of them come in, start citing precedents. So-and-so versus so-and-so, 1999 Supreme Court, 1275. I said, don't tell me the judgments, because the judgments are only the flesh and blood. The skeleton of the facts. So when you enter the bar, make it a habit to read the brief, to read the facts, and get it by heart, literally, so that you will be able to say what you want to say, not by reference to the papers, but as if you are recounting your own life experience. This is a very, very important suggestion that I would like to make to you, because this is something which I see sometimes wanting in the new generation of lawyers who come in these days. Because they are ready with the facts, they make it written down, they have all the judgments, they refer to it, start arguing. I tell them, get ready more and more so that you start speaking as if it is your life. So this is one thing which I want to say. Thank you, Mr. Ashokan, for reminding me of this, because this is something which I wanted to say, but which I've really missed out. Have I taken too much of time?
No.
Now that I've taken so much of time, I don't want to continue. So I'm so glad and I'm honored, humbled actually, to have been invited to the Golden Jubilee celebrations of this great, great college. It's a wonderful campus actually. A beautiful hall. Ernakulam Law College doesn't have this. It's a great hall. It looks like a cinema theater actually, with all the lightings and all that.
They are more benefited by your talk. Any amount of time.
I'll possibly take this building to Ernakulam. We don't have a building like this there. So it's a great experience and a great honor. What a privilege. I'll just close by telling you that we talk about human rights on a continuous basis now. The events of the days are all based on human rights. This is something which I want the lawyers you are certainly the chamberlains of the human rights of the clients who come to you. Human rights is not something that is abstract. Human rights is something that is what you want for yourself, which you see in another. You have possibly read about human rights by saying it is inalienable, fundamental, and common to everyone in the world. And therefore, when you talk about a human right, you are talking about something which every human must have for the purpose of existence. So when a client comes to you, when you see a problem, please understand that it is your own. And when you have that empathy, when you feel for your client and understand that this client, if I were in his shoes, what I would have done, that will then spur you to greater endeavor. It's exactly what we do on the bench also. On the bench, we only see the client, we understand his state of mind, the agony or the problem that he's going through. And the moment you step into that shoes, then there are no limits of jurisdiction, because you try to get that done, get that resolved in the manner that is possible, as I would do it for myself. If I were having that problem, if you are having a problem, and what you would have done for yourself is what you should be doing for the client. So this is really in its simplistic way of saying what human rights are. Human rights are those rights that you would want for yourself, which you should now concede to the other. So when you understand the concept of human rights in those sense, and we are talking about the importance of human rights now, all the judgments that you see, all that which you now credit me with, which I am not really deserving really, is all because we are only thinking about the concepts of human rights from the constitutional preambles and the constitutional imperatives of our great nation. Our preamble and the constitution tells us what the human rights are. And it is a wonderful, felicitous mix of every right any person in the world would require to live, our constitution. Everything that is required, it is there in the constitution. See the preamble. I said in Trivandrum also, a preamble is not specifically worded, but it is generally worded. That is because when you say something in a general sense, it is not that it is evasive. It is slightly general, because that can be adopted and used in any kind of scenario. This is where the judges find it easy to deal with the Constitution, because any life problem we can bring into one or the other concepts of the Constitution. And the human rights is something which is absolutely visible from the Constitution. And as long as you abide by the constitutional imperatives, and you understand what the Constitution wants out of you, human rights becomes a second nature. It is not something that you should think about as an abstract concept, something that you do every day. As a lawyer, you work human rights every moment of your life. What you're really doing is to deal with human rights on a continuous basis. Every moment, every case involves a human right. The problem that is presented to you is generally because one or the other rights are violated. It could be a statutory right, constitutional right, human right, fundamental right, or whatever. But in its essence, it is a human right which somebody feels or perceives has been snatched from them. So you will become the operators of human rights every day of your life the moment you start, when you enroll with the Bar Council. That's the importance of this profession. This is something which we miss out until you become maybe 15 or 20 years into the profession, to understand that all the last 10 years or 15 years or 20 years of my life, what I was really doing is that I was a champion of human rights. So when you understand that you're dealing with the rights of another person, the human rights of another human, obviously your responsibility becomes higher. I don't have to tell you how to do it, because I'm certain that you will feel the empathy, you will feel the need to support that person as you would support somebody whom you know very dearly, maybe even your family member. So this is what I want to tell you. In fact, this is what I want to open with today, because Justice Krishnayar, there could be no greater champion of human rights anyone could see than Justice Krishnayar. The concept of public interest litigation, was nothing but an offshoot of the urge to ensure human rights to everyone. Because even if you don't have a locus, you can come and tell me that, look, somebody who can't come to you has a problem, has a violation. And then I take that list as a public investigation and then deliver judgment on that as if I'm delivering to the person who could not come to me. Wonderful concept. It was possibly the best known innovation that Indian law could have given us. So everything that you do, you will be operating human rights. So keep an eye on that. Please understand your importance as an advocate. And I'm certain that all of you will do exceptionally well. And I'm sure that I'm going to see the next generation of judges from here. And I hope to listen to you when I retire and I become older than what I look today. I hope to hear you in the audience one day. And I look forward to that day. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for grinding up this event with your presence.
There is somebody.
Words,
you,
sir.
One second. Where is she?
Gayatri Vich.
Michael. All right.
Michael, you, Gayatri Vich.
I think you can ask. I can hear. My ears are good. Malayalathil parnjollo. Malayalathil parnjollo. We are all Malayalis, right?
I'm first year and studying first year LLB in this college.
503, 5 years.
3 year
course. Okay. You are a graduate already, right?
I'm a chartered accountant with profession. After that, joined the LLB. In this OTM, quality of legal education in Pochari. Sir, we have experience in doubt. New generation lawyers can handle it. But on the Chief Justice forum, or pendency of case.
It's a trick question. It's a trick question because yes. The answer is Yanamangil. I must think that I'm a good lawyer, which I can't really think of now. But I'll assume that I'm a good lawyer and I'll answer it. Now, what you study in law colleges is only 5% of what you carry as an advocate. You will see when you join the bar that nothing you study, nothing you really go through your textbooks are what is being applied in the courts. This is why I said earlier, lawyers are different by the way you handle the law, where you operate the law. So to say that someone is not a good lawyer is not because you do not have a good education. Not at all. I don't think so. Because the basic education that you get in any law college, the so-called new generation law colleges and all that, it possibly equips you to do a little bit of research more. But then even that is not really very relevant anymore because the information technology outburst that you are now seeing. So it's not really that you are getting a bad education or a good education. It's a way you equip yourself. You are a chartered accountant, I'll tell you, you add value to yourself. When you make your flow sheet and your charts and all that, or on the credits and the debits. If your credit and if your debits are more than the credit, you flop it. It's at least if it is equal that the account becomes operational. And if it is positive, your business is won. So it depends on how you handle yourself as an advocate, not as a law student. I studied from the Government Law College. I don't think I'm bad for that. I'm bad perhaps for other reasons, but not because my college was bad. Our college is the best. The Calicut Law College is possibly the best. Why not? Why should you think that there is a new generation college? This is also new generation enough. It all depends on how you think. New generation is not the infrastructure. New generation is the way you think. If you think like a new generation, you are a new generation lawyer. Just equip yourself. Go on, keep on preparing yourself. Add value to yourself. Every day is an adding value process. And when you keep on adding value, and you understand that I am better today than I was yesterday, your accounts are positive. There is nothing called a new generation lawyer. We are all good lawyers. Don't be worried about when you see somebody with flashy, clothes or a computer and all that. That is not a lawyer. A good lawyer is who thinks like a good lawyer.
One more question.
Endo. Okay.
Answer.
Vinanda. I think it's about 45 minutes after. LA.
Good afternoon. My name is Pradeep Kumar. I'm studying at Institute College of Data Studies.
Just call me, sir. Just call me, sir. Or you can call me by name, no problem.
By the advancement of the data communication system, the law has been become easily accessible to everyone. And service at my question is this. If the position of law in modern times is as much, is there any need for changing the language of law?
Language?
Yeah.
You are talking about simplifying the language.
Yes, exactly.
You see, all these jargons that we use is possibly to impress than more than anything else. You have alternate words for all this. You have an alternate word for ultra-vires, contrary. It's all. Ultra-vires means contrary. It's ultra-vires a constitution. Ultra-vires is a constitution. It is contrary to the constitution. There are options even in your ordinary language. But then you will see this when you start practice. You feel that urge to use this jargon to impress others, actually, more than anything else, really speaking. So it's not that you don't have to simplify the language is already simple. Now, if you're talking about Malayalam being switched, I am not against it. I have no problem there. Tragically, I think most of you are also, just as I am. We are all trained in English, all our inputs were in English. So it'll be difficult for our generation to now shift into a language that quickly, because we are now used to this. I may not be able to dictate a judgment with the kind of finesse that I do in English if I use Malayalam. That's because we are not trained in Malayalam yet. Malayalam arilanalla, I can speak Malayalam better than any one of you. But the problem is that I'm not trained in Malayalam, I don't know the legal jargon in Malayalam, so therefore it becomes difficult when I have to shift to Malayalam. Now the Google translator does it for you, but not very faithfully. 90% chances that your translation is okay. But there may be problems. So, but there is another reason why there should be a common language, be that Hindi or English, it depends. Because as an advocate, you can practice in any other high court also, or any other court in the country actually, except the Supreme Court when you have to appear through an advocate on record. For example, I used to appear in most of the high courts. Wherever I wanted to go, it is a great pleasure. But then if I'm trained only in Malayalam, if I have to argue in Madras or I have to argue in Andhra or anywhere else, it becomes a problem for me. So unless there is a common language for the entire state, entire nation, sorry, either that be Hindi or English, I think as long as Hindi is not a viable alternative, English should continue. I think English will continue. There is nothing else that we have. There is no other language. That's a problem. It's a national language now at the moment. That's not bad. Arnolo, no, I can hear you. അതാ ഞാൻ നേരത്തെ പറഞ്ഞു എന്താ പേര് നാൻസി ലോ സ്റ്റുഡൻ്റ് ആയിട്ട് അത് ചോദിച്ചാൽ എന്ത് ചെയ്യും നാൻസി എൻ്റെ ആൻസർ ഇറ്റ് വാസ് ദെയർ ഇൻ മൈ ഏർലിയർ ആൻസേഴ്സ് ആക്ച്വലി ഞാൻ അതാ പറഞ്ഞേ ഇരുന്നോളൂ പ്ലീസ് യു ക്യാൻ ഗെറ്റ് ആൻസേഴ്സ് ടു എനി ലീഗൽ ക്വസ്റ്റ്യൻ ഓൺ ദ കമ്പ്യൂട്ടർ ട്രൈ ചെയ്ത് നോക്കിക്കോളൂ ബട്ട് ഇൻവേരിയബ്ലി ദറ്റ് ആൻസർ വിൽ ബി ഓൺലി വൺ ഇൻവേരിയബ്ലി Because it goes with a particular kind of algorithm. You see, you should understand, every computer software works on algorithms. The set algorithm will give you one kind of an answer. Artificial intelligence is always artificial. Human intelligence is always human. never can artificial intelligence substitute human intelligence. Never. So this is what I said. As a lawyer, as a good lawyer, you should be in a position to understand the permutations and combinations in such manner that the same set of issues can give you multiple choices of solutions. And it is your expertise to take that choice which is the best for your client. And that is a hallmark of a good lawyer. So for a lawyer, it is not one algorithm. ഏത് പ്രോബ്ലം വന്നാലും ഏത് ഇഷ്യൂ വന്നാലും യു വിൽ സി നിങ്ങൾക്ക് ഇപ്പോൾ എക്സ്പീരിയൻസ് ഇല്ലാത്തതുകൊണ്ട് മനസ്സിലാവാത്തതാണ്. ഒരു നോട്ടത്തിൽ യു വിൽ ഗെറ്റ് വൺ കൈൻഡ് ഓഫ് എ സൊല്യൂഷൻ. ലുക്ക് ഇറ്റ് അഗെയിൻ, യു വിൽ ഗെറ്റ് എ സെക്കൻഡ് സൊല്യൂഷൻ. ലുക്ക് ഇറ്റ് മൾട്ടിപ്പിൾ ടൈംസ്, യു വിൽ ഗെറ്റ് മൾട്ടിപ്പിൾ സൊല്യൂഷൻസ്. ദിസ് ഈസ് നോട്ട് വാട്ട് ദ കമ്പ്യൂട്ടർ ക്യാൻ എവർ ഡു, അറ്റ്ലീസ്റ്റ് നോട്ട് ആസ് ഓഫ് നൗ. സോ വെൻ യു ഗെറ്റ് മൾട്ടിപ്പിൾ സൊല്യൂഷൻസ്, ഹൗ യു യൂസ് ഇറ്റ് ഈസ് എ ഹാൾമാർക്ക് ഓഫ് എ ലോയർ. സോ നാൻസി, ദാറ്റ് ഈസ് വാട്ട് യു ഷുഡ് ബി ട്രൈങ് ഫോർ. So I'll stop formally inaugurating this program, and thank you for the time, and thank you for honoring me like this. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for coming up this event with your presence and inspirational words, sir. We express our unfathomable sense of gratefulness to you for those absolutely great words and your witness. Gaining knowledge is the first step to wisdom. Sharing it is the first step to humanity. On this note, now, may I have the honor of inviting our guest of honor for the day, respected academic Mr. M. Achoke, over to the dais for sharing his great insights with us on the topic, the art of cross-examination. We have had a warmest welcome to you, sir. Please.
Those who are on the veranda can come inside. Some additional benches are provided. You can please take your seat there.
President of the function, Principal of the Law College, Chief Guest, Justice Dayan Ramendran, dignitaries on the dais and off the dais, students of the various law colleges, junior lawyers, faculties of this college and other colleges, my warm greetings to all of you. I have been invited here to talk to you about the art of cross-examination. I am very thankful to the organizers for giving me an opportunity to talk on a subject which is very live, which is very interesting, and which is very fascinating also. I have been invited probably because I have put in more years of experience, about 50 years of experience as a lawyer cross-examining witnesses. Apart from that, I don't think I have any other qualifications. There are better lawyers here. There are lawyers who are more proficient in cross-examining witnesses than me, but must be because of the years of experience put in by me. Now, I have been lecturing on the subject art of cross-examination in several other forums, various bar associations in Kerala and outside Kerala used to invite me for lecturing on art of cross-examination. But there was a difference in the audience. Most of the participants were practicing lawyers who were proficient in cross-examining witnesses. As I told you earlier, some of them were more proficient than me. And all of them were practicing lawyers, and all of them were interested in knowing what exactly is cross-examination and whether there are any new techniques in cross-examination. Therefore, it was a live discussion between the speaker and the audience, and both of us benefited. Now, the difference is, I find that majority of the members of this audience are law students who are going to enter into the profession next year, or say next year or the next year to come. And some of them are junior lawyers. And therefore, I assume that they have no idea about cross-examination. And they apprehend what to do when they are getting an opportunity to cross-examine. Where to begin the cross-examination? Where to end it? What is to be brought out? How they are going to prove that what is stated by a particular witness, deposed by a particular witness in the chief examination is not correct? That is what I am supposed to tell you. Now, my first endeavor is to see that the apprehension in your mind is taken away and that you need not be afraid of entering into the profession and cross-examining witnesses. For this purpose, I would like to put myself into your shoes and remember a day in 1972 July where I walked into the office of my great guru, Mr. K. Bhaskaran Nair, who was a versatile lawyer at that time. And when I entered his office, I knew nothing about cross-examination, except that I have read something, some of the provisions of the Criminal Procedure Code, Evidence Act, Civil Procedure, and absolutely nothing more. From there, it is only due to hard work, only by burning midnight oil, I have reached this position. And I want to remind you, it is not at all difficult, provided you are prepared to work hard. And that is the advice which I want to give you. And see, I remember the first day when I entered the court, I watched efficient lawyers, cross-examining witnesses. I did not understand a word of that. I did not know why all these questions are put. I did not know how they are going to elicit answers from the witnesses. But later on, after studying, I have come to know that there is a purpose in cross-examination and that it will be easy when you are prepared to study things and to enter into the field of cross-examination. Now, cross-examination is a very difficult, in fact, it is the hardest courtroom skills that a lawyer should possess. But before that, I tell you, see, there are three things that a lawyer should possess. One is skill for drafting. The second is for cross-examination. Probably high court lawyers and Supreme Court lawyers may not require that, but that basic things they must know. And the third is arguments, how to present your case effectively. For drafting, you have to be thorough with the facts of the case. You have to go on discussing with your client and find out what exactly is his grievance, what exactly is his case, and what are the documents, and what are all the things you want to impress upon the court by presenting it before the court. And I'm told that Fallius Nariman, who used to prepare petitions, affidavits, and other things, I'm told by the Bombay lawyers that he used to write, rewrite, correct, recorrect, and do it 100 times before the final draft is ready and it is handed over to the solicitor. And the result is that it will be perfect and 50% of the case is won by the intellectual and perfect drafting. So that is one thing. I am not going very much on that. If you read the famous autobiography of Fallius Nariman, Before Memory Fades, I'm sure some of you might have read that. If you have not read that, you find a book and read it. Then second thing, cross-examination, which I am going to deal with later. The third one is presenting your case and arguing it before a court of law. For that also, you must be proficient with the facts of the case, with the evidence, and also the case law. Case law means not only the provisions of law, but the judgments passed by the High Court, Supreme Court, and precedents, including foreign judgments, including Privy Council judgments. All those things you must be very familiar. Not that you may require all that to be presented before the court. It is just like preparing for an examination. When you prepare for an examination, you have to answer only, say, 20 or 50 questions. For that, you are preparing, you are studying answers for a lakh and odd questions. Why? Because to be proficient in the particular subject, it is necessary that you should prepare. Then, see, while presenting the case, if you are not able to present your case properly in the court, it is as good as the case is lost. And I heard that Nani Palkiwala was the most impressive. He addressed the most impressive arguments before the court, and I have heard that the Privy Purse case argument and also the constitutional matters in which he propounded the basic structure theory are monuments of best arguments. You must read that also. That will be available in the YouTube. And if occasion comes and if you get opportunity, you have to read it. Then another thing about becoming a good lawyer, I saw somebody asking about new generation lawyers, then information technology and all that. I tell you my experience. Way back in 1972, computer was not there, internet was not there. The senior will ask me to find out what is the actual position in a given set of facts and circumstances. I start perusing the yearly digest, the quinquennial digest, and other digests. I'll find that there is some judgments on that point. While going through that judgments, while going through the digest, I'll come across other positions also. By the time I get ready to present it before my senior, I must have gone through several positions, legal positions, and I am getting conversant with all those positions. And what is the benefit? Today, I can just get what is there on a particular position. I get that and I present it before the court. That is the difference. And of course, there are advantages and disadvantages. But the advantages were more because to a beginner, he'll be coming across several positions while looking for a particular position. Then art of cross-examination. See why it is called an art. It is called an art because there are no specific rules. The approach by one cross-examiner will be quite different from another cross-examiner. There are no rules as such. And the only thing is that you must get the desired answers from the witness, and ultimately you find that you succeed in the cross-examination. It is almost like a painter painting a good picture. There is no rules, and since there are no rules and it is left to the sweet will and pressure of the cross-examiner and also his experience and also his capacity to get answers for winning the case, that is it, and that is why it is called an art. Now, I tell you what is meant by cross-examination. Cross-examination is usually done after the chief examination. It need not necessarily follow the chief examination. Supposing a witness is called by the court as a court witness, then you will be asked to cross-examine because some of the points will have to be clarified. The chance of cross-examination is allowed to be done by the other party for the purpose of confirming that what is deposed by the witness in the chief examination can be accepted or not. Cross-examination is for eliciting answers which will show that what has been stated by the witness in chief examination is not correct or that it cannot be accepted as such. Cross-examination is for eliciting answers in such a manner that your case is made more probable than the adversary's case. By a successful cross-examination, you win 50% of the case. Then how cross-examination began for the first time? See, for your purpose, it is essential to know what is the beginning of cross-examination. There is the biblical story and also the Roman story. Both are one and the same. There, in old times, when a woman is accused of the offense of prostitution, the punishment prescribed is stoning that woman to death. And the evidence required is the two elders. Elders means citizens who are entitled to vote. And only socially and economically forward people will be eligible to vote. And when these two persons say that this lady is living on prostitution, immediately order is passed to stone her to death. One day, this allegation was made by two elders only because she was not willing to oblige to their illegal requests. And the Senate was about to pass the judgment to stone her to death. Immediately, a wise gentleman rose from his seat and said, "I want to put two questions to the persons who are accusing her of this offense." And he requested that one accuser may be kept away while I am cross-examining the other accuser. This went on for some time, and ultimately it was proved that the entire story is false. The lady was set free, and the false accusers were convicted. This is the starting of the cross-examination. I have mentioned about that story only for the reason, only for you to understand the importance of cross-examination. But for the cross-examination done by the wise person, the lady would have been stoned to death. That is the case now also. If a proper cross-examination is not done, the poor innocent persons who are accused of the offense will be convicted without a proper trial. That is the importance of the cross-examination. And by cross-examining successfully, you save a person from jail, you save a person from death sentence, you save a person from life imprisonment. All that is done with the help of cross-examination, wherein the true facts are brought out by the cross-examiner, and the court is convinced that the accusation made against the accused is incorrect. And this is one of the reasons why lawyer's profession is called a noble profession. That is for the purpose of bringing out the truth so that justice can be achieved, to see that no wrong is done in the name of justice and the poor innocent persons are not convicted. Now, I'll come to the most important portion, part of our lecture, that is how to prepare for cross-examination. By making oneself thoroughly acquainted with the facts of the case. How to make yourself thoroughly acquainted with the facts of the case? You have to read reread and going on reading the previous statements. If it is a criminal case, if it is a civil case, you have to go on reading the plaint, you have to go on reading the written statement and other documents, and you have to read it in such a manner that you are acquainted with the facts without even going to the paper, going through the paper once again. Then you should be thorough with the provisions of law. See, there is no purpose in entering into a cross-examination without knowing what exactly is the accusation against the accused, without knowing under what provisions of law he is going to be tried, without knowing what is the charge against the accused. So that it is very important that one should know what exactly is the allegation and what exactly is the provision of law and what is meant or what is desired by bringing out answers in cross-examination. I'll give you one example. Sri K. Kunjiramamenon was one of the stalwarts of the profession. And I used to approach him whenever it is necessary and whenever it is convenient for him. And when I approach him, he asked me, "Mr. Ashokan, what is the offense alleged?" For example, I may say it is section 324 IPC. You do one thing, you read 324. I'll start reading. He might have gone through that provision more than a lakh and odd times. I would have gone through that provision more than 100 times. Then also he is asking, before starting the discussion, he is asking me to read section 324. What is the purpose? He has explained to me, the purpose is, when you read it next time, you may get a new idea, and that will help you in conducting the case, that will help you in cross-examining the witness. So, one should know what exactly is the facts and what exactly is to be cross-examined. Cross-examination is the hardest courtroom skills, because you don't get time to take a decision. When you are cross-examining the witness is giving you an adverse answer. You have to get over that. You have to get rid of that answer. How? You have to frame questions in your mind. There is no time. In a splash, in a split second, you have to take a decision. And that is why it is called one of the hardest courtroom skills. A beginner will have absolutely no clue as to what is to be done in the cross-examination. Even if a beginner is thorough with the facts and law and is ready with the necessary questions, one may not know where to begin and where to end. Is it really difficult to learn cross-examination? My answer is, it is not that difficult as you think. Because according to me, it is as difficult as learning swimming or cycling. Those of you know cycling, that while learning cycling, you remember how difficult it was. Your mentor will ask you to hold the handles, to keep your legs on the pedals, sit straight and walk straight and look straight to the front side. And once you leave, or once you are not concentrating, once you are not looking to the front side, you will fall down. And you fall down several times. You think that you will never be able to learn cycling. And one day, you find that you are able to cycle without the ride, without the help of the mentor. Next day, you find that you can even leave one hand and hold the handle with the other hand and go on cycling. After some time, you find that you need not even catch the handle. You can leave both the hands. Then you will place your legs on the handle, and without any difficulty, you will ride the cycle. Cross-examination is also like that. And swimming, see, you might be drinking dirty water several times. You will have an impression that you are going to die drinking water and you will never be able to swim. But once you learn swimming, then that becomes very easy. Cross-examination is also like that. Now, I'm saying about all that because I am an experienced person who can tell you. It is to take the fear out of you and to make you brave and to make you proficient and to make you capable of cross-examining the witness. I have compared it with cycling and swimming so that it is not at all difficult. Once you start studying the facts in such a manner that you are thorough with it and the provisions of law, and when you know what exactly you are to bring out from the witness, it becomes easy. Then, the points to be borne in mind while you try to learn cross-examination by watching experienced cross-examiners. It is only due to constraints of time that I am briefing my lecture and I am telling you only the important points. See, the best way to learn cross-examination is watching others cross-examine witnesses. And when you watch others cross-examine witness, you will know how they are handling the witnesses, how they are tackling the situation, and how they are eliciting answers. If you go on doing like that, say for 5 or 6 days, then you will get an idea as to how to cross-examine the witness. And then when you start cross-examining the witness, you find that it is not as difficult as you were thinking. And that is the reason why you are always asked to watch others, not only your senior, but generally the lawyers conducting cross-examination. You must thoroughly exploit the experience that you have earned by watching brilliant cross-examiners cross-examining witnesses. Then I tell you, your watching need not confine to seniors' cross-examination alone. See, you can watch the cross-examination of juniors also. I tell you this because there are two aspects. Every man will have novel ideas. When a junior lawyer is cross-examining, he will be cross-examining with a novel idea which others were not having. You can learn that, and at times that may be beneficial in eliciting answers. And supposing if the junior is committing a mistake by asking a straight question or by putting a particular question, if he is getting adverse answers and if he is not able to get adverse, favorable answers later on, that will be a lesson to you and not to put such questions unless you feel yourself capable of getting amendments and getting correct answers from the witness. You have to find out how the cross-examiner is managing various situations while the cross-examination is going on. See, when you are cross-examining the witness, there will be several situations. The court may not like the cross-examination. The witness may not be cooperating with you. And the facts also may not be very much in your favor. But still you have to continue with the cross-examination. And you have to continue with the cross-examination till you are getting the desired answers. For that, you have to equip yourself and you have to train yourself as to how that is to be done. You have to find out how the cross-examiner He is asking difficult and untoward questions to the witness without incurring the displeasure of the court. See, I say without incurring, Justice Devanramindran may excuse me, displeasure of the court means court may not like the witness to be harassed, but you will have to ask the question, and only when you ask the question you will get the answer, and you will have to frame the questions, and you will have to put the questions in such a manner that you are not incurring the displeasure of the court. You have to learn how the cross-examiner is keeping cool and calm even when he is getting unfavorable answers from the witness, and how he is continuing the cross-examination and ultimately getting the desired answer. That is something which you can learn only by watching cross-examination and only by sitting in the court hall watching how the cross-examiner is proceeding. You have to find out how the cross-examiner is managing the courts, especially when a particular court is hostile towards you or your case. There may be occasions when the court is not pleased with your manners, the court is not pleased with your appearance, court is not pleased with the facts. But even then, you have to continue with the cross-examination and you have to acquire the skills. For the purpose of an effective cross-examination, you have to be thorough with the facts. For this, you have to go through the facts again and again until you are thorough with the same. See, there was a very senior lawyer in Kerala, and he used cases almost in all the districts in Kerala. What he used to do is, the case diary statements, which is the basis of the chief examination, he used to rewrite it 4 or 5 times with his own hand. Mind you, he is a very busy lawyer, having cases almost in all the districts, 302 murder cases. Even then, before starting cross-examination, he used to write the CD statements in his own hand 4 or 5 times. What is the purpose? To make himself thorough with the facts. That is the importance of getting oneself thorough with the facts. You have to be thorough with not only the facts which are favorable to you, but also with the entire facts, whether it is unfavorable, favorable or not. This is for the reason that you should not be taken by surprise by anybody, including the witnesses. See, you must be aware of what are the shortcomings, what are the disadvantages, what are the points against you. You have to learn that, and that you have to bear in mind, it has to be borne in mind before starting the cross-examination. If you want, you can prepare draft questions and find out whether anything is missing or anything is to be added or deleted. I have seen several lawyers preparing an elaborate questionnaire and asking questions one by one without missing anything. There are several successful lawyers who adopt this practice. But when you have more number of cases, you may not get time for all that. See, that is one method, but I tell you, I am not adopting that method. But difficulty with that method is that you will have a tendency to stick on the prepared questionnaire, which may not be successful always, because the next question depends upon the answer given to the previous question. So that necessarily question will have to be changed from the questionnaire list. There are lawyers who never used to keep a list of questions in a written form, but they stuff everything into their memory and go on cross-examining for hours together without committing any serious omissions. In fact, I have got great respect for such lawyers, and that is what you have to develop if you want to become very successful in the profession. By gaining more and more experience, there are some people who can just hear the chief examination and to have a full-fledged cross-examination of the witness. Mr. K. Kunjiramamenon was such a person. I remember after my completing 5 years of practice, one day I was sitting in the CJM court. Then Mr. K. Kunjiramamenon came and I offered my seat. Then I got the seat again. Then he was asking, "What is your matter, Mr. Ashokan?" I said, "Sir, it is a cheating case. So it's under Section 420. Yes. See, what is the allegation against you? What is your defense? Then who are all the witnesses?" I gave him answer for all these questions. Then the case was called. The chief examination was over. When I was about to stand up for cross-examination, he just put his hand on me and said, "I'll ask a few questions. Then you can take over." You won't believe, he cross-examined for less than 10 minutes. Entire case was demolished. Then he asked me, "You want to ask any more questions?" I said, "No, I don't want to ask any more questions." That is experience. And don't think that you'll be able to do that when you start practice. But when you are an experienced lawyer and your ability is also like that, probably you may be able to do it. I'm telling you all that because Kunjiramamenon also must have his years of beginning where he might have strained hard for learning cross-examination. Then, see, while cross-examining a witness, you have to ascertain the antecedents about him so that you can put those antecedents to him in cross-examination. You have to ascertain whether the witness is speaking truth or falsehood. You have to be very sure as to what are the questions to be asked and what are the desired answers for the set questions. See, some youngsters have got a feeling that while cross-examining the witness, any questions can be put to them. No, it is not like that. See, you have to decide in your mind as to what are the questions to be put to the witness and probably what answer you will get for those questions. If you are not sure of the answer, don't ask the questions because that will have the effect of reaffirming what has been stated in the chief examination. So don't do that. Ask questions only if you are thorough what answer will be given by the witness. Then you must be very watchful from the beginning till the end, and you must have a clear and cogent picture of the witness. See, at the time of roll call, when the name of the witness is called, you have to watch him. You have to watch him enter into the witness box. Why? Because by the time you learn to cross-examine a witness, more or less you will become a psychologist. You will be able to read the mind of the witness. And when the witness is entering the box, just by looking at his face, you will be able to understand whether he is speaking the truth or whether he is made to speak falsehood at the instance of somebody else. Knowing that or assuming what is the position that is important for cross-examination. You must know what questions you have to avoid. If you ask such a question and get an unfavorable answer, the same would spoil the entire cross-examination. See, there are questions of which you are sure that you will not get a favorable answer. You don't ask those questions. If you ask those questions and get unfavorable answers, that will spoil your case. Then another thing that you have to keep in mind is when you get a favorable answer, never try to improve on that. If you try to improve on that, what will happen is, at times, the witness by that time will understand his folly. And for the next question, he will correct himself, and the answer which you have already got will be nullified. But you can venture to further cross-examine the witness and get the answers clarified, provided you feel that the witness is such a witness that he will go on giving answers like that. Or when you feel that you yourself is capable of that. You should not get upset when unfavorable answers are given by the witness. You have to switch on to the next question and conveniently come back to get the right answer to the question. See, that is something which the new lawyers have to be taken care of. See, when you are cross-examining the witness, you get an unfavorable answer. You get a negative answer from the witness. Normally, you will get upset and you will not be able to continue with the cross-examination. If you continue with the same set of facts, questioning on the same set of facts, you will continue to get unfavorable answers. You must be in a position to manage the situation. You have to shift from that and go to some other facts, go to some other aspects, and come back only later. That is something which you will be able to manage by your experience in the court. You must perfectly understand that the witness is not your personal enemy. You have to be very friendly with the witness. By irritating the witness, normally you won't get the desired result. That is a mistake usually committed by lawyers, even experienced lawyers. They fail to understand why this man is in the witness box, only because either he happened to see it or he has been compelled by somebody to be a witness. See, there is no personal enmity between yourself and the witness. You treat the witness as a human being, try to ask the questions politely, and ultimately you will get the desired answers. By irritating the witness, after some time you may be able to do so many things, but not as a beginner. As a beginner, you have to be very careful. And you should avoid, as far as possible, any quarrel with the witness. And you have to also understand that cross-examination is an unequal battle between the witness and the lawyer. Lawyer is in an advantageous position. And the moment you lose that advantage and the witness gains it, then you are finished. You will not be able to continue with the cross-examination and your case will be as good as lost. You have to be very careful while cross-examining disabled witness. You have to cross-examine, but disabled witness will have the sympathy of the court, and you have to be very careful in dealing with such witnesses. While cross-examining the witness, you have to be thorough with the subject and give an impression. See, that is regarding expert witness. When you cross-examine the expert witness, you have to study as to how he has come to that opinion, what are the tests conducted by him, what exactly are the facts of the case, whether he has done the tests as prescribed. All that you have to find out, and you have to give an impression that you know more than the expert who is coming as the witness. See, now there is a change in the cross-examination yesterday and today. And what will be the cross-examination of tomorrow? I'll tell you about that. When I started practice, cross-examination mainly in criminal matters was to bring out contradictions, major contradictions, and major omissions amounting to contradictions. After cross-examination of the witnesses, the deposition will be studded with contradictions and serious omissions. And normally, the court will disbelieve the witness. And when the witnesses one after the other are disbelieved, the result is the case will end in acquittal. After some time, after about 20 to 25 years, the scenario changed. And a total case, by cross-examining the witness, you have to bring out a total case which is in your favor. Your case is made more probable than the prosecution case. Cross-examination is not concentrating on contradictions and omissions alone. And in fact, that became the order of the day, and that was what was happening even now. That is happening even now. But for cross-examination tomorrow, Justice Devan Ramendran has given me a hint. Now, see, supposing there is a murder case, there are three witnesses who are occurrence witness. A few years back, the cross-examination is mainly on the question whether the witnesses have actually witnessed the incident or not. Then questions are hurled in cross-examination to these witnesses. The witnesses say that I have witnessed the incident, which was around 10 a.m. Another witness will come and say that it was after taking lunch, about 1 p.m., that the incident had taken place. Another witness will say it was from the shore of a river. Another witness will say that it is from the valley of a mountain. Like that, the witnesses will go on. In the cross-examination, witnesses will go on giving answer. Ultimately, witness will be disbelieved. But tomorrow, mind you, that is mobile tower location will be a crucial aspect in placing the location of the witnesses. Prosecution will be able to prove where the witnesses were actually there. Then there will be the TV images. Then there will be other evidence to show that, as a matter of fact, these persons were actually there and they had witnessed the incident. What will you do? Then you have to cross-examine. Your old cross-examination will not be of no avail. You have to prepare for that also. Then the fear complex in your mind, which I started, that you have to get rid of that for the purpose of learning cross-examination. And another aspect which Justice Devan Ramendran has referred to, see, you have to be thorough with not only the subject. General reading is a must to become a good lawyer. See, you have to read the Puranas. You have to read the Greek epics, Iliad and Odyssey you have to read. You have to read Dostoevsky and Tolstoy. You have to read Tirukural, Agananuru and Purananuru. What for? Not to become a great lawyer, but for enhancing your mental capacity, enhancing your brain, and to become a cosmopolitan citizen. A cosmopolitan outlook is necessary for a successful cross-examination. When I tell you that it is necessary, you may not. The sunset of my life, the complete darkness is nearby, but you are going to enter into the profession. And I tell you, tomorrow, when a murder case is there, the images from the brain, from the dead brain, that will be available before the court, which will go to show what exactly had happened at the time of murder. Then also, you will have to cross-examine the witnesses, you have to cross-examine the experts, and prove that your client is innocent. That is a challenging profession. And once again, my dear young friends, a warm welcome to all of you into the profession. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much for this highly informative, absolutely amazing talk, sir. We've been extremely fortunate to be able to listen to you, and we're sure that your words will certainly be a lighthouse of guidance for the budding boys here who are entering the profession in upcoming years. A memento is a memory of the time spent together.
So in another 5 to 10 minutes, the program will come to an end, and I am pleased to inform you that lunch is arranged for all those who have come here. Kozhikode biryani is arranged, okay? And those classrooms where you were writing the essays in the morning, that place will become the classroom. Okay. Now, yes, two more things. This college for the last 50 years was not having a logo of its own. Fortunately, one of the students of this college has designed a beautiful logo which was widely appreciated by all. So, as a token of appreciation of having designed such a wonderful logo of this college, the principal wants that student to be recognized, and the chief guest is requested to unveil the logo along with the guest of honor to show that this is the logo that one of the students, not even a professional, a student has designed for this college. I would request the chief guest and the guest of honor to kindly unveil the logo. Neville Noble and team. Harishankar, Vishnu Kumaran, Kevin John.
Then from LLM, Sherin.
From LLM, Sherin, Bennett, Gayatri, and Abhijit. A wonderful team.
The team behind.
Yeah. Give a big hand to all these young talents. So, certificate, sir? Kumar, sir? Kurtan, you have to go to the sir. Who? Neville Noble? Neville. Harishankar? 95 LLB, Harishankar?
Kevin John.
Kevin John? Vishnu Sukumaran? Sherin C. Abraham? Bennett? Abhijit? Abhijit? Gayatri. Vaichu. Vishnu Sukumaran. Now, I am pleased to inform you all that our guest of honor, Advocate M. Ashokan sir, is in his 15th year of legal practice. Half a century is over in the legal practice, and he still holds the ground as strong as any young man. To mark the celebrations of the 15th year of his legal practice, we the juniors, his colleagues and his well-wishers have decided to celebrate it throughout this year, and to mark the beginning of that, I would request the chief guest to kindly have a present a ponnada to our beloved Ashokan sir. We have Dr. N.L. Sajikumar sir, who had submitted a thesis and he was awarded PhD, and his study was based on illegitimate children. According to him, the term illegitimate should be avoided, because even when children are involved in case, they are not called criminals or offenders. So, illegitimate, the right of children born out of the wedlock, that was the topic. And he has submitted a paper to the Law Commission as well. We would request the chief guest to kindly honor him with a ponnada. I would now request principal to kindly hand over the mementos to the chief guest and the guest of honor as a token of our pleasure and appreciation and gratitude. Over to Dr. N.L. Sajikumar sir, and which will be followed by the vote of thanks by Vidyut sir. Over to you, sir. One of the most important events that is going to happen, declaration of results of the essay writing competition held this morning, and the cash award will also be given right now. It was a wonderful competition, and I heard that there are three third prizes even. So the judges The panel of judges consisting of four senior professors found it very difficult to declare the first, second, third. So here are the results.
പ്രിയമുള്ളവരെ, എസ് റൈറ്റിംഗ് കോമ്പറ്റീഷനിൽ നമുക്ക് ജയിക്കാൻ തോക്കാം, പക്ഷേ ജീവിതത്തിലും ലീഗൽ പ്രൊഫഷനിലും ജയിക്കാനായിട്ട് നിങ്ങൾക്കൊക്കെ മാതൃകയാക്കാൻ പറ്റുന്ന കുറച്ച് ആളുകളെ നിങ്ങൾക്ക് ഈ വേദിയിൽ കാണാൻ പറ്റും. അതിലെനിക്ക് ആദ്യമായിട്ട് പറയാൻ ഞാൻ ഓരോ ലെയറിൽ നിന്ന് ഞാൻ പറഞ്ഞുതരാം. ആദ്യമായിട്ട് നമ്മൾ നീതി ദേവത എന്നൊക്കെ കേട്ടിട്ടുണ്ട്, പക്ഷേ നമ്മൾ ജസ്റ്റിസ് ദേവൻ എന്നിടുമ്പോൾ അത് നീതി ദേവൻ എന്നാണ് ട്രാൻസ്ലേഷൻ ആവുന്നത്. അപ്പോൾ അത് എന്തുകൊണ്ട് ഞാൻ പറഞ്ഞു എന്ന് പറഞ്ഞാൽ, അത് ദൈവികമായിരിക്കും. ജസ്റ്റിസ് എന്ന പേരും കൂടെ ആഡ് ചെയ്ത് ദേവൻ എന്ന സാറിൻ്റെ പേര് വന്നത്. അതെ, നമ്മൾ സാധാരണ ലോ പഠിക്കുന്ന വിദ്യാർത്ഥി നിങ്ങൾക്കറിയാം, നമ്മളിപ്പോൾ കോടതി തന്നെ പറയുന്നുണ്ട്, നോട്ട് ബൈ വേർഡ്സ് ബട്ട് ബൈ ഡീഡ്സ് എവറിത്തിങ് ഹാസ് ടു ബി കൗണ്ടഡ് ആണല്ലോ. അങ്ങനെയാണ് നിങ്ങൾ പഠിച്ചത്. പക്ഷേ ഞാനൊക്കെ പറയുന്നത് വേർഡ്സും നോട്ട് ബൈ വേർഡ്സ് ബട്ട് ബൈ ഡീഡ്സ് ശരി തന്നെയാണ്, പക്ഷേ വേർഡ്സും ഡീഡ്സും ഒരുമിപ്പിക്കുമ്പോഴാണ് യഥാർത്ഥത്തിൽ അതിൻ്റെ പൂർണ്ണത വരുന്നത്. ആ വേർഡ്സും ഡീഡ്സും ഒരുമിക്കുന്നവരെയാണ് നമ്മൾ യഥാർത്ഥത്തിൽ ജഡ്ജാണെന്ന് ജഡ്ജ് ചെയ്യേണ്ടത്. അത് ഞാൻ എൻ്റെ ഒരു പേഴ്സണൽ ഒരു അനുഭവം ഷെയർ ചെയ്യണം. നിങ്ങൾ പലരും ജഡ്ജസ് ആവും, അപ്പോൾ നിങ്ങൾ അതിനകത്ത് ചെയ്യാൻ വേണ്ടി പറഞ്ഞു തരാം. അപ്പോൾ ഞാൻ സാറിൻ്റെ കൂടെ കഴിഞ്ഞൊരു 2 weeks മുമ്പ് പറഞ്ഞു, സാറ് തന്നെ പറഞ്ഞല്ലോ, ട്രിവാൻഡ്രത്ത് ഒരു ഫംഗ്ഷന് വന്നപ്പോൾ ഓൺ ദ വേ കാറിലിങ്ങനെ പൊയ്ക്കൊണ്ടിരുന്നപ്പോൾ സാർ വളരെ സന്തോഷമായിട്ട് കാര്യങ്ങൾ പറഞ്ഞു തുടങ്ങിയപ്പോൾ പെട്ടെന്ന് സാറിൻ്റെ മോഹം ഭയങ്കരമായിട്ട് ഡൗണായി. അപ്പോൾ സാറ് ഈ സൈഡിൽ വെച്ചിരിക്കുന്ന ഫ്ലെക്സുകളെ പറ്റിയാണ് സാറിങ്ങനെ മനസ്സിനകത്ത്, സാറിൻ്റെ ഓൾറെഡി നല്ല ഗ്ലാമറുമാണ് നല്ല കളറുമാണ്, പക്ഷേ ആ ഒരു സമയത്ത് കുറച്ചും കൂടെ എന്ത് ചെയ്തു, കുറച്ചും കൂടെ എന്നിട്ട് സജ്ജി എൻ്റെ വിധികളൊന്നും ഇവിടെ ആർക്കും അറിയാറില്ല എന്നിങ്ങനെ ചോദിക്കുക. അപ്പോൾ എനിക്ക് മനസ്സിലായില്ല എന്താണെന്ന്. പക്ഷേ അടുത്ത സെക്കൻഡ് സാറ് പറഞ്ഞു, കണ്ടില്ലേ ഫ്ലക്സുകളെന്ന്. എന്നിട്ടത് മാത്രമല്ല, സാർ ആ ഫംഗ്ഷൻ കഴിഞ്ഞ സമയത്ത്, കഴിഞ്ഞൊരു കൊടുങ്കാറ്റൊക്കെ അടിക്കുന്ന സമയത്ത് യൂണിവേഴ്സിറ്റിയുടെ മുമ്പിൽ വലിയ ഫ്ലക്സൊക്കെ വെച്ചിരിക്കുക, അപ്പോൾ അത് കാറ്റത്ത് ഇങ്ങനെ ഒലഞ്ഞ് ആളുകളുടെ പുറത്ത് വീഴാൻ സാധ്യതയുള്ളപ്പോൾ സാർ അപ്പം തന്നെ എൻ്റെ മുമ്പിൽ വെച്ചിട്ട്, സാർ ഞാനത് പറയുന്നത് ഓൾറെഡി ഇത് പത്രത്തിൽ റിപ്പോർട്ട് ചെയ്ത് വന്ന കാര്യം കൂടെയാണ്. സാർ അപ്പം തന്നെ പോലീസ് ഓഫീസ് പറഞ്ഞിട്ട് അവിടുത്തെ കോപ്പറേഷൻ സെക്രട്ടറിയെ വിളിച്ച് വരുത്തിയിട്ട് അതിനുടൻ തന്നെ ഇമ്മീഡിയറ്റ് പിറ്റേന്ന് തന്നെ നീതി കിട്ടണം എന്ന് പറഞ്ഞു വൺ ചെയ്തു. അപ്പോൾ പുള്ളി അതിനെ എന്ത് ചെയ്തു, ജസ്റ്റിഫൈ വേണ്ടി നമ്മൾ എല്ലാ മാസവും ഒരു ഡ്രൈവ് നടത്തുന്നുണ്ട്, ഈ ഫ്ലക്സുകളൊക്കെ ചുമന്ന് മാറ്റാറുണ്ടെന്ന് പറഞ്ഞു. അപ്പോൾ സാറ് പറഞ്ഞു അതാണ് അടുത്ത കുറ്റം, അതെവിടെ കൊണ്ട് ഡിസ്പോസ് ചെയ്യും അതും എനിക്കറിയണം. അപ്പോൾ വേർഡ്സ് മാത്രമല്ല, വേർഡ്സിലും ഡീഡ്സിലും ഒരേപോലെ. അപ്പോൾ ഞാനൊക്കെ പഠിച്ച ജുഡീഷ്യൽ പ്രോസസ്സൊക്കെ പഠിച്ചിട്ടുണ്ട്, അപ്പോൾ അതൊക്കെ ബുക്ക് വായിച്ച് കോടതിയിൽ തീരുന്ന ജുഡീഷ്യൽ പ്രോസസ്സ് മാത്രമേ നമ്മൾ കണ്ടിട്ടുള്ളൂ കേട്ടിട്ടുള്ളൂ. അപ്പോൾ ഇങ്ങനെയുള്ള നല്ല മനുഷ്യരിവിടെ ഉണ്ടെന്നുള്ളതിനകത്തൊരു സന്തോഷം. അപ്പോൾ സാറിന് എന്നിട്ട് പറഞ്ഞു, കേരളത്തിനെ ദൈവം രക്ഷിക്കട്ടെ എന്ന് പറഞ്ഞു. അപ്പോൾ സാറിനെ പോലുള്ള നല്ല ആളുകളെ ദൈവം രക്ഷിക്കട്ടെ, സാറിൻ്റെ കൂടെ എപ്പോഴും ദൈവം കാണട്ടെ. പിന്നെ അതേപോലെ തന്നെ നമ്മളിപ്പോൾ ഹിസ്റ്ററിക്കലായിട്ട് പഠിക്കുമ്പോൾ, നമ്മളിപ്പോൾ ഇംഗ്ലീഷ് പഠിക്കുമ്പോൾ ലോർഡ് കോക്ക് നിയമ രാജവാഴ്ച മാറ്റി നിയമ വാഴ്ച ഇട്ടതും, അല്ലെങ്കിൽ ലോർഡ് ഡെന്നിങ് ഡെസേർട്ടഡ് വൈഫ്സിന് നീതി കൊടുത്ത, അങ്ങനെ ഒരുപാട് ഇംഗ്ലീഷ് ജഡ്ജസിനെ പറ്റി നമ്മൾ പഠിക്കുന്നുണ്ട്. ഇനി നമ്മൾ US ചീഫ് ജസ്റ്റിസ് മാർഷലും അല്ലെങ്കിൽ ഒലിവർ വെൻഡൽ ഹോംസൊക്കെ പഠിക്കുന്നു. ഇന്ത്യയിലോട്ട് വരുമ്പോഴും നമുക്ക് അങ്ങനെ വിരലെണ്ണാവുന്ന എത്രയോ ജഡ്ജസ് ഇരുന്ന രാജ്യമാണ്. അപ്പോൾ നമ്മൾ ഫസൽ അലി അല്ലെങ്കിൽ ഖന്ന, ജസ്റ്റിസ് വി ആർ കൃഷ്ണയ്യർ, അതേപോലെ ആ ഒരു ശ്രേണിയിൽ ഹിസ്റ്ററിയിൽ സാറിൻ്റെ പേര് രേഖപ്പെടുത്തും എന്നുള്ളതിനകത്ത് യാതൊരു സംശയമില്ല. അപ്പോൾ നിങ്ങളുടെയൊക്കെ പ്രാർത്ഥന ദൈവത്തിനോട് അതായിരിക്കും. അപ്പോൾ സാറിൻ്റെ തന്നെ ഒരു തത്വം ഇതാണ്, സാറിൻ്റെ ജഡ്മെൻസിൽ നിന്ന് വളരെ ഒറ്റ പോയിൻ്റ് ഞാൻ സാറിനെ പറ്റി എനിക്ക് ഒറ്റ വാക്കിയേ പറയാനുള്ളൂ, റെസ്പെക്ട് എവറി ഡ്രോപ്പ് ഓഫ് വാട്ടർ എയ്തർ ഫ്രം ദ സ്കൈ ഓർ ഐ, ഇതാണ് സാറിൻ്റെ തീരുമാനം. ഒന്നുകൂടെ ഞാൻ റെസ്പെക്ട് പറയാം, റെസ്പെക്ട് എവറി ഡ്രോപ്പ് ഓഫ് വാട്ടർ എയ്തർ ഫ്രം ദി സ്കൈ ഓർ ഐ, ഇതാണ് സാറിൻ്റെ തത്വം, ഇത് നിങ്ങൾ മാതൃകയാക്കുക. ഇനി അടുത്ത് എനിക്ക് പറയാനുള്ളത് പ്രഗത്ഭനായ അഡ്വക്കേറ്റ് സാറിനെ പറ്റി സ്റ്റാൻഡിങ്ങും ഒക്കെ പറഞ്ഞു കഴിഞ്ഞു. അപ്പോൾ സാറും ഭയങ്കരമായിട്ട് എല്ലാ കൂടുതലും മോട്ടിവേറ്റ് ചെയ്തു, സാർ സാറിൻ്റെ ക്ലാസ്സൊക്കെ എടുത്തു. അപ്പോൾ സാറ് പറഞ്ഞതിനകത്ത് ഒരു സാറിൻ്റെ വേർഡ്സിൻ്റെ ഒരു കാര്യം, സാറ് പറഞ്ഞതിനകത്ത് തത്വം ഇതേ ഉള്ളൂ, വേർഡ്സ് എന്ന് പറഞ്ഞു അല്ലേ, വേർഡ്സ് വെച്ചിട്ടുള്ളൊരു കളിയാണല്ലോ ക്രോസ് എക്സാമിനേഷനും എല്ലാം. അപ്പോൾ ആ വേർഡ്സ് ഒരു താക്കോൽ പോലെ കീ പോലെയാണെന്നാണ് നമ്മൾ അതിനകത്ത് മനസ്സിലാക്കേണ്ടത്. വേർഡ്സ് ആർ ലൈക്ക് കീസ്, നമ്മളതിനെ കറക്റ്റ് ചൂസ് ചെയ്ത് നമ്മൾ ഉപയോഗിച്ചാൽ വി ക്യാൻ ഓപ്പൺ ഹാർട്ട്സ് ആസ് വെൽ ആസ് ഷട്ട് ദ മൗത്ത് ഓഫ് ദി ഓപ്പോസിറ്റ് പാർട്ടി. അപ്പോൾ ഹൗ ടു ചൂസ്, വാട്ട് ടു ചൂസ്, ഇതാണ് അവിടെയും വേർഡ്സ് എന്നുള്ളൊരു പ്രാധാന്യം ഞാൻ. അപ്പോൾ സാറിൻ്റെ ഇതിനകത്ത് എനിക്ക് വേർഡ്സും ഡീഡ്സും ഒരുമിച്ച് പോകണമെന്ന് പറഞ്ഞു. അടുത്ത ഞാൻ വക്കീലിൻ്റെ കാര്യം പറയുമ്പോൾ വേർഡ്സിനാണ് നിങ്ങൾ ഏറ്റവും പ്രാധാന്യം കൊടുക്കേണ്ടത്. how to choose words, how to choose appropriate word in the right context. It is like key. It can open the heart of the judge, provided the judge should have heart. I underline that. Okay. ഇനി അടുത്ത നമുക്ക് കാണാൻ കഴിയുന്നത് അധ്യാപകരുടെ വലിപ്പത്തെ നമ്മുടെ വിദ്യതുണ്ട്, പിന്നെ നമ്മുടെ ബഹുമാനമായ പ്രിൻസിപ്പൽ സാറുണ്ട്. അപ്പം നമ്മുടെയൊക്കെ അതൊരു ടീം എഫേർട്ട്. അപ്പോൾ എന്തോ എനിക്ക് ഇവിടെ കോളേജിൽ വന്നിട്ട് എനിക്കത് അനുഭവിച്ചറിഞ്ഞു. നമ്മുടെ ടീം ഓഫ് ടീച്ചേഴ്സുണ്ട്, ലോവൽ മാൻ അനീസ്, ഞാൻ പേര് പറയുന്നില്ല, രമ്യ, എല്ലാ ടീച്ചേഴ്സും നമുക്ക് അറിയാമല്ലോ. അപ്പം നമ്മൾ ഇത്രയും ഈ 50 വർഷമായിട്ടും ഈ കോളേജും ഈ ഏരിയ മലബാറിൽ ലീഗൽ എഡ്യൂക്കേഷൻ റിസർച്ചും ഒരു ഡെവലപ്മെൻറ്റും ഇല്ലായിരുന്നു. അപ്പോൾ കഴിഞ്ഞ പ്രിൻസിപ്പൽ നമ്മുടെ ജയദേവൻ സാർ, അത് സന്തോഷത്തെ ദേവൻ സാറിൻ്റെ ക്ലാസ്മേറ്റും കൂടെയാണെന്ന് ഞാൻ പറഞ്ഞു. അപ്പോൾ സാറിൻ്റെ ക്ലാസ്മേറ്റായ ജയദേവൻ സാറ് പ്രിൻസിപ്പലായിരുന്ന സമയത്തും നമ്മൾ ടീം വർക്ക് കുമാര സാറും ഒക്കെ കൂടെ ചേർന്നിട്ട് ഈ മലബാർ, നമ്മുടെ ഗവൺമെൻറ് ലോ കോളേജല്ല, മലബാർ ലീഗൽ എഡ്യൂക്കേഷൻ്റെയും ലീഗൽ റിസർച്ചിൻ്റെയും ഒരു ഹബ്ബാക്കി മാറ്റാനുള്ള ഒരുപാട് പ്രവർത്തനങ്ങൾ ഇത് കൂടെ ചെയ്യുന്നുണ്ട്. അതിന് ഈ കോളേജിലെ എല്ലാ വിദ്യാർത്ഥികളുടെയും സപ്പോർട്ടുണ്ട്. അപ്പോൾ അങ്ങനെ ഒരു ടീം സ്പിരിറ്റോടുകൂടി കോളേജ് കൊണ്ട് നടക്കാൻ പറ്റുന്ന മാതൃകാപരമായിട്ടുള്ള പ്രിൻസിപ്പലും അധ്യാപകരുമുള്ള കോളേജാണിത്. ഇനി അടുത്ത വേറൊന്ന്, ഒരു നവാസ് സാറ്, നമ്മളൊരു സോൾജിയർ ടേൺഡ് അല്ല സോൾജിയർ ടേൺഡ് ലോയർ ഓർ സോഷ്യൽ എഞ്ചിനീയർ. നമുക്ക് സാധാരണ ഈ സോൾജിയർ ലോയർ അല്ലെങ്കിൽ ജൂറിസ്റ്റ് ആകുമ്പോൾ നിങ്ങൾക്ക് വിഷമമാണ്, കാരണം നിങ്ങൾ ഓസ്റ്റിനെയൊക്കെ പറ്റി പഠിച്ചതാണ്. അയാൾ സോൾജിയറായിട്ട് ലോയിൽ വന്നപ്പോഴും അവിടെയും ലോയർ ഗൺമാൻ തിയറി വെച്ചിട്ട് കമാൻഡ് ഓഫ് ദ സോവറൻ എന്ന് പറഞ്ഞ് ജസ്റ്റിസിനെ ടോട്ടലി ഇഗ്നോർ ചെയ്തു. ഈവൻ ദോ അയാൾക്ക് സോൾജിയറായ സമയത്ത് ജെ എസ് മില്ലിൻ്റെയും അങ്ങനെയുള്ള ബന്ധത്തിൻ്റെ ആ ഐഡിയ കിട്ടിയിട്ട് പോലും നന്നായില്ല. പക്ഷേ ഇവിടെയും നമുക്ക് കാണാവും ഒരു സോൾജിയർ റിട്ടയർഡായിട്ട് സാറ് നവാസ് സാർ ഒരു സോൾജിയർ ടേൺഡ് ലോയറായി. അപ്പോൾ സാറിന് ഒരുപാട് നമ്മുടെ ജസ്റ്റിസ് വി ആർ കൃഷ്ണയ്യ സാറിൻ്റെ ഒരു മകൻ അല്ലെങ്കിൽ ഒരു ചെറുമകൻ്റെ സ്ഥാനമായിരുന്നു എന്ന് എനിക്ക് മനസ്സിലാക്കാൻ കഴിഞ്ഞിട്ടുണ്ട്. അപ്പോൾ ആ സാറിൻ്റെയൊക്കെ ഇതും കൂടെ ഉള്ളതുകൊണ്ട് സാറ് സോൾജിയറുമാണ്, അത് ടേൺഡ് ലോയറാണ്, ജസ്റ്റിസിന് വേണ്ടി പടവരുന്നു എന്നുള്ള ഉറപ്പാണ്. ഇത് കൃഷ്ണയ്യർ സാറ് തന്നെ നവാസാനത്ത് പറഞ്ഞിട്ടുണ്ട്, രാജ്യത്തിനെ ഡിഫെൻഡ് ചെയ്ത നവാസിന് എന്തുകൊണ്ട് നീതിയെ ഡിഫെൻഡ് ചെയ്തുകൂടാന്ന് ചോദിച്ചിട്ടുണ്ട്. അപ്പോൾ ആ പശ്ചാത്തലത്തിൽ സാറ് വളരെ ശോഭിക്കുന്ന ഒരാളായിട്ട് മാറട്ടെ, മാറും. പിന്നെ ഞാൻ അതിനകത്ത് സരീന മാഡം, നമ്മൾ പറയാറുണ്ടല്ലോ ബിഹൈൻഡ് ദ ഫോർച്യൂൺ ഓഫ് എവറി മാൻ ദർ ഈസ് എ ഫോർച്യൂൺ ഓഫ് എവറി മാൻ ദർ ഈസ് എ, അത് ഉറപ്പില്ല. അപ്പോൾ പണ്ട് ഞാനിടയ്ക്ക് അത് ഇടയ്ക്ക് പത്രമൊക്കെ വായിക്കാൻ വേണ്ടി ക്രിമിനോളജിയൊക്കെ പഠിച്ച സമയത്ത് എനിക്ക് സംശയം വന്നു, ഇത് ശരിയല്ലല്ലോ, ബിഹൈൻഡ് ദ ഫോർച്യൂൺ ഓഫ് എവറി മാൻ ദർ ഈസ് എ ക്രൈം ആൻഡ് ദാറ്റ് ബിഹൈൻഡ് ദാറ്റ് ക്രൈം ദർ ഈസ് എ ഉമൺ എന്നായിരുന്നു ഞാനത് തെറ്റിദ്ധരിച്ചത്. പക്ഷേ ഇപ്പോൾ എനിക്ക് മനസ്സിലായി പണ്ടുള്ള ആൾ പറഞ്ഞു തന്നെയാണ് ശരി, ബിഹൈൻഡ് ദ ഫോർച്യൂൺ ഓഫ് എവറി മാൻ ദർ ഈസ് എ ഉമൺ. അപ്പോൾ ഈ സാറിൻ്റെ നവാസ് സാറിൻ്റെ കൂടെ അതും ക്യാപ്റ്റനായിരുന്നു, ക്യാപ്റ്റനായിട്ട് ആ ഒരു ജോലി തന്നെ ഭയങ്കര ഒരു സോഷ്യൽ ആക്ടിവിറ്റീസൊക്കെ ചെയ്യുന്നു. ഇപ്പോൾ സരീന മാഡം ഉണ്ട്, ഇത്രയാണ് ഞാൻ പറയുന്നത്. പിന്നെ നമുക്കൊക്കെ കൂടെ ചേർന്നിട്ട് ഒരു ജോയിൻ്റ് ഒരു കാര്യം നിങ്ങൾക്ക് മെസ്സേജ് തരാനുണ്ട്. അത് ഞാൻ ഏറ്റവും പ്രഗത്ഭനായിട്ടുള്ള കാർഡോസോ, ജസ്റ്റിസ് കാർഡോസോ ലോ ഗ്രാജുവേറ്റ്സിന് നടത്തിയ ഒരു കൺക്ലൂഷൻ പാരഗ്രാഫ് ഇങ്ങനെ പുള്ളി പറഞ്ഞത്, ഏറ്റവും ഫേമസ് ലോയറാണ്, നിങ്ങൾ നേച്ചർ ഓഫ് ജുഡീഷ്യൽ പ്രോസസ്സൊക്കെ പഠിക്കും അല്ലെ, പഠിച്ചു കാണും. ഇങ്ങനെ ഞാൻ കൺക്ലൂഡ് ചെയ്തത്, ദ ഫ്യൂച്ചർ ജെൻറ്റിൽമെൻ ഈസ് യുവേഴ്സ്, വി ഹാവ് ബീൻ കോൾ ടു ഡു അവർ പാർട്ട് ഇൻ ആൻ ഏജ്ലെസ് പ്രോസസ്, ലോങ് ആഫ്റ്റർ ഐ ആം ഡെഡ് ആൻഡ് ഗോൺ ആൻഡ് മൈ ലിറ്റിൽ റോൾ ഇൻ ഇറ്റ് ഈസ് ഫോർഗട്ടൺ, ബട്ട് യു ആർ ഹിയർ ടു ഡു യുവർ ഷെയർ ആൻഡ് ഐ ആം ഷുവർ ദ ടോർച്ച് വിൽ ബി ബേണിംഗ് മോർ ബ്രൈറ്റ്ലി വെൻ ഇറ്റ് ഈസ് ഇൻ യുവർ കീപ്പിംഗ്. അതേ മെസ്സേജ് തന്നെയാണ് ഈ വേദിയിൽ ഇവിടെ ഇരിക്കുന്ന എല്ലാവർക്കും നിങ്ങളുടെ തരാനുള്ളത്. നിങ്ങളുടെ കൈകളിലാണ് ആ ദീപശിഖ, നിങ്ങളെ നല്ലോണം മുന്നോട്ട് കൊണ്ടുപോകും. നമ്മുടെ രാജ്യത്തിനെ ദൈവം രക്ഷിക്കുന്നതിൻ്റെ കൂടെ ദൈവത്തിൻ്റെ പോരാളികളായിട്ട് നിങ്ങൾ ഓരോരുത്തരും മാറണം. നമ്മുടെയൊക്കെ എന്ത് ഹെൽപ്പും നമുക്ക് നമ്മൾ ചെയ്യുന്നതായിരിക്കും എന്നുള്ള വാഗ്ദാനം തന്നുകൊണ്ട് ഞാൻ എൻ്റെ റിസൾട്ട്സിലോട്ട് കടക്കാം. അപ്പോൾ ഇതിലെ ജയം തോൽവിയും നിങ്ങൾ വിഷമിക്കേണ്ട, ജീവിതത്തിലും പ്രൊഫഷനിലും എങ്ങനെ ജയിക്കാം എങ്ങനെ തോക്കാം എന്ന് ഞാൻ പറഞ്ഞു കഴിഞ്ഞു. നെക്സ്റ്റ് സാറിൻ്റെ ദേവസ്ഥാൻ്റെയും സാറിൻ്റെയൊക്കെ അനുഭവത്തോടി എൻ്റെ റിസൾട്ട് അനൗൺസ് ചെയ്യുകയാണ്. ടോപ്പിക്ക് തന്നെ വളരെ മനോഹരമായിട്ട് ടോപ്പിക്കാണ്, അപ്പോയിൻമെൻറ്റ് ടു ഹയർ ജുഡീഷ്യറി ഇൻ ഇന്ത്യ, നീഡ് ഫോർ ഓവർ ഹോളിംഗ്. ലോട്ടിട്ട് എടുത്ത ടോപ്പിക് അതായിരുന്നു സാർ, ജുഡീഷ്യൽ അപ്പോയിൻമെൻറ്റ്സ് ഇൻ ദ ഹയർ ജുഡീഷ്യറി ഇൻ ഇന്ത്യ, നീഡ് ഫോർ എ ഓവർ ഹോളിംഗ്. അപ്പോൾ അതിൽ ഒരുപാട് 70 പേരത് അപ്ലൈ ചെയ്തു. കഴിഞ്ഞ പ്രാവശ്യം നമ്മൾ പി ആർ ടി സി നവസാൻ്റെ പി ആർ ടി സി ഇത് നടത്തി, അന്ന് ഞാൻ അതിനകത്ത് ഭാഗമായി. അന്ന് ഫസ്റ്റും സെക്കൻഡോ കിട്ടിയത് ഡൽഹി യൂണിവേഴ്സിറ്റിയിലെ ഒരു കുട്ടിക്കും, പേര് ഞാൻ മറന്നുപോയി, ക്യാഷ് അവാർഡ് കൊടുത്തു. പിന്നെ അലിഗഡ് മുസ്ലിം യൂണിവേഴ്സിറ്റിയിലും ജാമിയ മിലിയ യൂണിവേഴ്സിറ്റിയിലും അവിടുത്തെ കുട്ടിയൊക്കെയാണ് അത് കിട്ടിയതെന്ന് പറഞ്ഞു. ഇപ്പം നമ്മൾ തേർഡ് പ്രൈസ് 3 പേര് ഷെയർ ചെയ്തിരിക്കുക. ദ ഫസ്റ്റ് വൺ ശിൽപ ബി, ഡിപ്പാർട്ട്മെൻറ്റ് ഓഫ് ലോ, കാര്യവട്ടം, യൂണിവേഴ്സിറ്റി ഓഫ് കേരള. Congratulations. Next one, Mohammed University, Marcus Law College. Very good. And the third one who shared third prize is? All the very best. Shilpabi. Shilpabi. From Department of Law, Karyavattam University, Kerala. Next, Mohammed Unais, Marcus Law College. And next one, Mainma Merlin Alexander from Government Law College, Calicut. Then second place, Mashood K of Government Law College, Calicut. And the first place goes to Faseeh PO, Government Law College, Calicut.
He is Faseeh. Come. Chartered accountant.
Yes. Faseeh PO, Government Law College, Calicut. ദേവൻ സാറിന് നിങ്ങളുടെ ഒന്നും കൂടെ രണ്ട് മിനിറ്റ് സംസാരിക്കണം.
ഇല്ല, സംസാരിക്കുന്നൊന്നുമില്ല, പേടിക്കണ്ട, ഡോണ്ട് വറി. നിങ്ങളുടെ ബിരിയാണി ഐ വിൽ നോട്ട് ഹോൾഡ് യു. വേഷം എന്ന് എല്ലാവരും ബിരിയാണി എന്ന് കേട്ട മുതൽ ഐ കൻ സി ഓൾ ദി ഗേൾസ് പുട്ടിംഗ് അപ് ദർ ഹാൻഡ്സ്. നോ, അശോകൻ, അഡ്വക്കേറ്റ് അശോകൻ ഇസ് കംപ്ലീറ്റിംഗ് 50 ഇയേഴ്സ് എന്ന് പറഞ്ഞപ്പോൾ ഐ തോട്ട് ഐ കൺഗ്രാജുലേറ്റ് ഹിം നോട്ട് പ്രൈവറ്റ്ലി ബട്ട് ഇൻ ദി പ്രസൻസ് ഓഫ് ഓൾ ഓഫ് യു. ഓൾ ദി വെരി ബെസ്റ്റ് സർ. ഇറ്റ്സ് നോട്ട് എ സ്മോൾ മൈൽ സ്റ്റോൺ. ഐ എം 53. ഐ ഹവ് ജസ്റ്റ് ലിവ് 53. ഹി ഹസ് പ്രാക്ടീസ് 50 ഇയേഴ്സ്. So, all the very best.
So, our program comes to end with a vote of thanks by Vidyut sir.
Hello. Bahubanapetta Adhyakshan Professor C.V. Kumaran sir, Honorable Justice Devan Ramendran sir, Advocate M. Ashogan sir, Sajikumar N.L. sir, Nawaz Jan and Captain Sarina ma'am. Priyapetta ellavarkkum ende vinidamaya namaskaram. Valare santoshathodum abhimanathodum koodeyanu njan ini veedil nilkunnathu. ഞാൻ എൻ്റെ വളരെ പ്രിയപ്പെട്ട, എൻ്റെ മനസ്സിനോട് വളരെ അടുത്ത് നിൽക്കുന്ന ഒരു വ്യക്തിത്വമാണ്, എൻ്റെ ജീവിതത്തിൽ വളരെയധികം സ്വാധീനിച്ച ഒരു വ്യക്തിത്വമാണ് എൻ്റെ പ്രിയപ്പെട്ട സീനിയർ ദേവൻ രാമേന്ദ്രൻ സർ. ഇങ്ങനെ ഒരു അവസരം സത്യം പറഞ്ഞാൽ എൻ്റെ വിദൂര സ്വപ്നങ്ങളിൽ പോലും ഇല്ലായിരുന്നു എന്നുള്ളതാണ് വാസ്തവം. നിറഞ്ഞ കണ്ണുകളോടെ അതിലേറെ സന്തോഷത്തോടെയാണ് ഇന്ന് ഈ വേദി ഞാൻ എൻ്റെ പ്രിയപ്പെട്ട ദേവൻ സാറുമായി പങ്കിടുന്നത് എന്ന് പറഞ്ഞുള്ളത്. എനിക്കെൻ്റെ സന്തോഷം വിവരിക്കാൻ കഴിയുന്നില്ല. എൻ്റെ മുഖം കണ്ടാൽ നിങ്ങൾക്ക് മനസ്സിലാവും, എൻ്റെ പരിചയമുള്ളവർക്ക് കണ്ടാൽ മനസ്സിലാവും. അപ്പോൾ വളരെ വളരെ സന്തോഷം. ഞാൻ നിങ്ങളുടെ ബിരിയാണിക്ക് വേണ്ടി വെയിറ്റ് ചെയ്യണമെന്ന് എനിക്കറിയാം, പക്ഷെ ഒരു 3 മിനിറ്റ് സമയം ഞാൻ എടുത്തോട്ടെ. ഞാനും സാറും തമ്മിലുള്ള ചില രസകരമായ നിമിഷങ്ങൾ നിങ്ങളുമായിട്ട് പങ്കുവെക്കണം എന്നെനിക്ക് തോന്നുന്നു. ഞാൻ LLM കഴിഞ്ഞ്, കൊച്ചിൻ യൂണിവേഴ്സിറ്റിയിൽ LLM കഴിഞ്ഞ് പ്രാക്ടീസ് ചെയ്യാനൊരു ഓഫീസ് അപ്പി നടക്കുമ്പോൾ എൻ്റെ സുഹൃത്ത് ഗൗതമിനോട് ഞാൻ ചോദിച്ചു, ഗൗതം എന്തെങ്കിലും ഓഫീസുണ്ടോ? എനിക്ക് പ്രാക്ടീസ് ചെയ്യാൻ എന്ന് പറഞ്ഞ് ഗൗതം സുബ്രഹ്മണ്യാണ് സാറിന് ഓർക്കുന്നുണ്ടോയെന്ന് അറിയില്ല. എങ്ങനെയാണ് അത് ഗൗതം സാറിൻ്റെ ഓഫീസ് സജസ്റ്റ് ചെയ്തതെന്ന് എനിക്കറിയില്ല. അങ്ങനെ എൻ്റെ സുഹൃത്ത് വഴിയാണ് ദേവൻ സാറിൻ്റെ ഓഫീസിലേക്ക് ഞാൻ എത്തുന്നത്. അപ്പം ഞാനൊരു സന്ധ്യയ്ക്കാണ് ഓഫീസിലേക്ക് കയറി ചെല്ലുന്നത്. എനിക്കൊരു പിടിയില്ല, ഞാൻ ഇതിനു മുമ്പ് കേട്ടിട്ടില്ല, ഞാൻ അങ്ങനെ ഒരു അന്വേഷണം നടത്തിയില്ല. അപ്പം ഇന്നതാണ് ഇവിടെയാണ് ഓഫീസ് എന്ന് പറഞ്ഞിട്ട് ഞാൻ എറണാകുളത്ത് സാറിൻ്റെ ഓഫീസിലേക്ക് കയറി ചെല്ലുകയാണ്. കയറി ചെല്ലുമ്പോൾ സാർ അവിടെയുണ്ട്, അധികം പേരില്ലായിരുന്നു, ഒരു 7 മണിക്ക് സമയത്താണ് ഞാൻ ചെല്ലുന്നത്. നോക്കിയപ്പോൾ നല്ല ചുള്ളനായിട്ടുള്ള ഒരാൾ, ഒടുക്കത്തെ ലുക്കാണെങ്കിലും നല്ല ബുദ്ധിയുമാണ്, അതാണ് സാറിൻ്റെ പ്രത്യേകത. അപ്പം ഞാനിങ്ങനെ വിചാരിച്ചേ ആള് കൊള്ളാമല്ലോ, ആള് വളരെ സ്മാർട്ടാണല്ലോ. പിന്നീട് ഞാൻ മനസ്സിലാക്കി ദേവരാമേന്ദ്രൻ സാറിന് ആ ഹൈക്കോടതിയിൽ നിരവധി ആരാധികമാരും ആരാധകന്മാരും ഉണ്ടായിരുന്നു കേട്ടോ. അപ്പോൾ ഞാൻ ദേവൻ സാറിൻ്റെ ഓഫീസിലാണ് വർക്ക് ചെയ്യുന്നതെന്ന് പറയുമ്പോൾ എന്നെ അസൂയയോടുകൂടെ നിൽക്കുന്ന നിരവധി സുഹൃത്തുക്കൾ എനിക്കുണ്ടായിരുന്നു എന്നും കൂടെ ഞാൻ പറഞ്ഞോട്ടെ. ഞാൻ ഓഫീസിൽ പ്രാക്ടീസ് ചെയ്യാൻ തുടങ്ങിയ സമയത്ത് സാറ് എനിക്കൊരു കെട്ട് ഡോക്യുമെൻറ്റ്സ് എടുത്ത് തന്നിട്ട് പറഞ്ഞു, ഇതൊന്ന് നോക്കിയിട്ട് എന്തെങ്കിലും കേസുണ്ടോ ഒന്ന് നോക്ക് വിദ്യത്തെ, എന്നിട്ടൊരു നോട്ടീസ് എഴുതാൻ പറ്റുമോ നോക്കുമെന്ന് പറഞ്ഞു. അതായിരുന്നു എനിക്ക് തന്ന ഫസ്റ്റ് അസൈൻമെൻറ്റ്. അതായത് ഒരു ഒരു ജൂനിയറിനെ ഒരു സീനിയർ എങ്ങനെ മോൾഡ് ചെയ്തെടുക്കുന്നു എന്നുള്ളതിൻ്റെ ഒരു ഉത്തമ ദൃഷ്ടാന്തമായിരുന്നു അവിടെ ഉണ്ടായിരുന്ന ആ ഒരു കാലഘട്ടം എന്നെ സംബന്ധിച്ച്. ഞാൻ ആ ഡോക്യുമെൻറ്റുകളിലൂടെ കടന്നു പോയിട്ട് ഒരു നോട്ടീസ് ഡ്രാഫ്റ്റ് ചെയ്ത് സാറിന് കൊടുത്തു. സാറെന്നെ ഹൃദയത്തിൽ നിന്ന് തന്നെ അപ്രീഷിയേറ്റ് ചെയ്യുകയും ചെയ്തു. ആ അപ്രിസിയേഷൻ ഒരു ജൂനിയർ എന്നുള്ള നിലയ്ക്ക് എനിക്ക് നൽകിയ കോൺഫിഡൻസ് ചെറുതല്ല. ഇപ്പോൾ പലപ്പോഴും ഞാൻ പിന്നീട് ഞാൻ ലോയേഴ്സിനെ കണ്ടിട്ടുണ്ട്, ജൂനിയേഴ്സിനെ തെറി പറഞ്ഞ് വളരെയധികം ടെൻഷൻ അടുപ്പിച്ച് നിർത്തുന്ന സീനിയേഴ്സ്. നിങ്ങൾ എത്ര പേര് അങ്ങനെ അത്തരം സീനിയേഴ്സിനെ അഭിമുഖീകരിച്ചിട്ടുണ്ടെന്ന് എനിക്കറിയില്ല. പക്ഷേ ദേവൻ സാറിൻ്റെ ആ ഒരു അപ്രിസിയേഷൻ എത്രത്തോളം നല്ലതായിരുന്നു എന്ന് എനിക്കറിയില്ല. പക്ഷേ ആ അപ്രിസിയേഷൻ എനിക്ക് തന്ന ഒരു ആത്മവിശ്വാസവും ഒരു എന്താ പറയുക, അവിടെ നിൽക്കാനുള്ള ഒരു സംതൃപ്തി, അവിടെ നിൽക്കാനുള്ള ഒരു തോന്നൽ ഒക്കെ ഉളവാക്കിയത് ഒരു ചില്ലറ കാര്യമല്ലെന്നാണ് ഞാൻ കരുതുന്നത്. പിന്നീട് വഴിയെ വഴിയെ ദേവൻ രാമചന്ദ്രൻ എന്ന ഒരു മനുഷ്യസ്നേഹിയെ എനിക്ക് മനസ്സിലാക്കാൻ ഒരവസരം കിട്ടി എന്നുള്ളതാണ്. ശരിക്കും ഇത് ഞാൻ വെറുതെ പറയുന്നില്ല, സാറിന് ഇരുത്തി ഞാൻ വെറുതെ പറയുന്നില്ല. ഞാൻ പലരോടും ഞാൻ പിന്നീട് എൻ്റെ ജീവിതത്തെ സ്വാധീനിച്ച വളരെ ചുരുക്കം വ്യക്തികളെ ഉള്ളൂ, അതിനകത്ത് ഏറ്റവും പ്രിഡോമിനൻ്റ് ആയിട്ട് നിൽക്കുന്ന ഒരാൾ ദേവൻ സാറാണ്. ഈ ദേവൻ സാറ് ഇടയ്ക്ക് ഓഫീസിൽ വന്നിട്ട് ആ സ്വാമിയുടെ സ്വാമിയെടുത്ത് പോയി സംസാരിച്ചു എന്ന് പറഞ്ഞ് ഇങ്ങനെ പറയുമായിരുന്നു ആ സ്വാമിയെടുത്ത് പോയി. അപ്പം ഞാൻ വിചാരിച്ചു ഏതാണ് ഈ സ്വാമി, സാറ് ഭയങ്കര ഭക്തനാണെന്ന് തോന്നുന്നത്, ഓഫീസിലൊക്കെ വരുന്നതിനും എപ്പോഴും സ്വാമിയെടുത്ത് പോയി സംസാരിക്കും. പിന്നെ ഞാൻ വിചാരിച്ചു ഇനിയിപ്പോൾ ആസാമി എന്നാണ് പറഞ്ഞത്, സാറൊരു ഒരു 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 എന്താ പറയുന്നത് വളരെ വിമർശനാത്മകമായി ചിന്തിക്കുകയും ഒക്കെ ഉള്ളൊരു വ്യക്തിയാണോ, ഏതോ സ്വാമി എടുത്ത് പോയ അയാളെക്കുറിച്ച് ആസാമി എന്ന് പറയണോ എന്നും ഞാൻ വിചാരിച്ചു. പക്ഷെ പിന്നീട് മനസ്സിലായി അല്ല, ശരിക്കും ഒരു സ്വാമിയെക്കുറിച്ച് തന്നെയാണ് പറയുന്നത്. ആ സ്വാമി വേറെ ആരുമല്ല, ജസ്റ്റിസ് വി ആർ കൃഷ്ണയ്യർ. വി ആർ കൃഷ്ണയ്യരുടെ, എന്നിട്ട് സാറ് കഥ പറയും, വി ആർ കൃഷ്ണയ്യരെടുത്ത് പോയിട്ട് വർത്തമാനം പറഞ്ഞിരുന്നത്, വീട്ടിൽ പോയി ഡെലിബറേറ്റ്ലി കൃഷ്ണയ്യർ സ്വാമിയുടെ വീട്ടിൽ പോയി വർത്തമാനം പറഞ്ഞിരിക്കുമായിരുന്നു, സാറിൻ്റെ അനുഭവങ്ങൾ കേൾക്കുമായിരുന്നു, സാറിന് ചോദിക്കാനുള്ള ചോദ്യങ്ങൾ ചോദിക്കുക എന്ന് പറഞ്ഞാൽ ഒരു ഒരു വളരെ നോളജബിളായിട്ടുള്ളൊരു വ്യക്തിയെ കിട്ടുമ്പോൾ എങ്ങനെയാണ് ആ വ്യക്തിയെ ഉപയോഗിച്ച് നമുക്ക് മാക്സിമം അറിവ് ആ വ്യക്തിയിൽ നിന്ന് ആർജിച്ചെടുക്കാൻ കഴിയുന്നത് എന്നുള്ളൊരു പാഠവും ഞാൻ ദേവൻ സാറിൽ നിന്ന് പഠിച്ചു എന്ന് പറഞ്ഞോട്ടെ. അതിൻ്റെ ഇപ്പോഴത്തെ ഒരു ബെനിഫിഷ്യറിയാണ് സർ ഡോക്ടർ, ഐ ഹോപ്പ് യു വുഡ് ബി ഡെഫിനറ്റ്ലി നോയിങ് ഡോക്ടർ ജി മോഹൻ ഗോപാൽ. ഞാൻ ഒരു പക്ഷേ സാറും മറ്റേ വി ആർ കൃഷ്ണയ്യർ തമ്മിലുള്ള ബന്ധത്തെ കുറിച്ച് ആലോചിക്കും, അല്ലെങ്കിൽ മോഹൻ ഗോപാൽ സാറിനും ഞാനും തമ്മിലുള്ള ബന്ധത്തെക്കുറിച്ച് ആലോചിക്കുമ്പോൾ എൻ്റെ മനസ്സിൽ വരുന്ന രണ്ട് പിക്ചർ എന്ന് പറയുന്നത് ദേവരാമേന്ദ്രൻ സാറും വി ആർ കൃഷ്ണയ്യർ സ്വാമിയാണ് എന്നുള്ളത് കൂടെ ഞാൻ ഓർക്കുകയാണ്, അയവിറക്കുകയാണ് അവരോർമ്മ. അത് കഴിഞ്ഞിട്ട് പിന്നെ അതുപോലെ തന്നെ ഞാൻ എൻ്റെ കുഞ്ഞിനോട്, എൻ്റെ മോള് വന്നു, ഇന്ന് മോളിനെ ഞാൻ സന്തോഷപൂർവ്വം പരിചയപ്പെടുത്തി. മോളിനോട് ഞാൻ എപ്പോഴും പറയും ഷെയറിങ്, നമ്മൾ ഷെയറിനെ കുറിച്ച് എപ്പോഴും ഷെയർ ചെയ്യണം, മറ്റുള്ളവരായിട്ട് നല്ല കാര്യങ്ങൾ ഷെയർ ചെയ്യണം. ഈ ഷെയറിനെ കുറിച്ച് ഞാൻ സത്യം പറഞ്ഞാൽ അറിഞ്ഞതും ഈ ദേവരാമേന്ദ്രൻ സാറിൽ നിന്നാണ്. അത് വേറെ ഷെയറല്ല, മറ്റേ കോർപ്പറേറ്റ് ഷെയറാണ്. അതായത് ഓഫീസിൽ ഒരു ചെറിയ ടി വി വെച്ചിട്ടുണ്ടായിരുന്നു, ആ ടി വിയിൽ എപ്പോഴും ഷെയർ മാർക്കറ്റ് നോക്കിയിരിക്കലായിരുന്നു അന്ന് ദേവൻ സാറിൻ്റെ ഒരു ആസ്പെക്റ്റ് എന്ന് പറഞ്ഞു കഴിഞ്ഞാൽ. അതിൽ നിന്ന് എക്സ്റ്റെൻഡ് ചെയ്തിട്ട് ജനങ്ങളുടെ ഡ്യൂ ഷെയർ നൽകുന്ന ഒരു മികച്ച ന്യായാധിപനായി പ്രവർത്തിക്കുന്നത് നമ്മളെല്ലാം കണ്ടുകൊണ്ടിരിക്കുക. അപ്പോൾ അത്തരത്തിൽ ഒരു എന്താ പറയുന്ന ഒരു വിശിഷ്ട വ്യക്തിത്വം തന്നെയാണ് ദേവരാമേന്ദ്രൻ സാർ. അപ്പോൾ അദ്ദേഹത്തിൻ്റെ ഒപ്പം വേദി പങ്കിടാനും ഞാൻ പഠിപ്പിക്കുന്ന ഈ കലാലയത്തിൽ അദ്ദേഹത്തെ ഒരു വിശിഷ്ട വ്യക്തിയായി ലഭിക്കാനും കഴിഞ്ഞതിൽ വളരെ വളരെ സന്തോഷം സർ. താങ്കൾ ഗവൺമെൻറ് ലോ കോളേജിൻ്റെയും പി ആർ ടി സിയുടെയും ക്ഷണം സ്വീകരിച്ച് ഈ തിരക്കിൻ്റെ ഇടയിലും വന്ന് വളരെ വിലപ്പെട്ട അനുഭവങ്ങളും ആശയങ്ങളും ഈ വിദ്യാർത്ഥികളുമായി പങ്കുവച്ചതിന് ഗവൺമെൻറ് ലോ കോളേജിലെ പ്രിൻസിപ്പളിൻ്റെയും സ്റ്റാഫിൻ്റെയും വിദ്യാർത്ഥികളുടെയും പിന്നെ പി ആർ ടി സിയുടെയും പേരിൽ നന്ദി രേഖപ്പെടുത്തുന്നു. വളരെ നന്ദി. പിന്നെ ഞാൻ അധികം സമയമെടുക്കുന്നില്ല. നമ്മുടെ ക്ഷണം സ്വീകരിച്ച് വളരെ സ്പെസിഫിക് ആയിട്ടുള്ള വളരെ പ്രധാനപ്പെട്ട ഒരു ടോപ്പിക്കിനകത്ത് നല്ല വ്യക്തമായി സംസാരിക്കുകയും അതിനെക്കുറിച്ചുള്ള അതിൻ്റെ പ്രാധാന്യം നിങ്ങൾക്ക് മനസ്സിലാക്കിപ്പിച്ച് തരികയും ചെയ്ത അഡ്വക്കേറ്റ് എം അശോകൻ സാറിനോട് ഗവൺമെൻറ് ലോ കോളേജിൻ്റെയും പി ആർ ടി സിയുടെയും പേരിലുള്ള ഹൃദയംഗമമായ നന്ദി രേഖപ്പെടുത്തുന്നു. സജികുമാർ, ഡോക്ടർ എൻ എൽ സജികുമാർ സാറ് ഒരു വിദേശിയല്ല, നമ്മുടെ ആൾ തന്നെയാണ്. അപ്പോൾ അദ്ദേഹം പുറത്തുനിന്ന് വരുന്നതായിട്ട് ഞാൻ കണക്കാക്കുന്നില്ല, അല്ലെങ്കിൽ നമ്മളാരും കണക്കാക്കുന്നില്ല. എങ്കിലും ഒരു ഫോർമാലിറ്റിയുടെ പേരിൽ എൻ എൽ സജികുമാർ സാറിന് ഗവൺമെൻറ് ലോ കോളേജിൻ്റെയും പി ആർ ടി സിയുടെയും നന്ദി രേഖപ്പെടുത്തുന്നു. നന്ദി സർ. പിന്നെ എന്നെ ഏൽപ്പിച്ചതുകൊണ്ട് മാത്രം ഈ ഉദ്യമത്തെ ഇത്തരത്തിൽ വളരെ വിജയകരമായ ഒരു ഇവൻ്റാക്കി മാറ്റിയ നിങ്ങളുടെ തന്നെ നമ്മുടെ തന്നെ അല്ലെങ്കിൽ നേതാവ് എന്നൊക്കെ വിളിക്കാവുന്ന നവാസ് ജാൻ സാറിനും ക്യാപ്റ്റൻ സെറീന മാഡത്തിനും ഉള്ള ഒരു നന്ദി എൻ്റെ വ്യക്തിപരമായ പേരിൽ ഞാൻ രേഖപ്പെടുത്തും. അതിനൊപ്പം ഒരു കാര്യം കൂടെ ഞാൻ പറഞ്ഞോട്ടെ, ബിഹൈൻഡ് എവരി മാൻ ദർ ഇസ് എ സക്സസ്ഫുൾ വുമൺ എന്ന തത്വം നമ്മൾ ഉപയോഗിക്കരുത് എന്നൊരു അപേക്ഷ എനിക്കുണ്ട്. കാരണം അതിൻ്റെ ഇംപ്ലിക്കേഷൻ മാനാണ് എപ്പോഴും സക്സസ്ഫുൾ എന്നും അതിൻ്റെ പിന്നിൽ ഒരു വുമണും ഉണ്ടെന്നാണ്. അങ്ങനെയല്ല, ദർ ഇസ് എ സക്സസ്ഫുൾ മാൻ ആൻഡ് ദർ ഇസ് എ സക്സസ്ഫുൾ വുമൺ, ഇറ്റ് ഈസ് നോട്ട് ബിഹൈൻഡ്. അപ്പോൾ ഐ വുഡ് സേ ദാറ്റ് സെറീന മാം ഇസ് എ സക്സസ്ഫുൾ വുമൺ, നവാസ് ജാൻ ഇസ് എ സക്സസ്ഫുൾ മാൻ. അപ്പം ബാക്കി എല്ലാവരും ഏറ്റവും അവസാനം നമ്മുടെ ഈ ഇവൻ്റ് റിപ്പോർട്ട് ചെയ്യാൻ വന്ന മാധ്യമ സുഹൃത്തുക്കൾക്ക് എല്ലാവർക്കും ഗവൺമെൻറ് ലോ കോളേജിൻ്റെ പേരിൽ നന്ദി അറിയിക്കുന്നു. ഇവിടെ സന്നിഹിതരായ മറ്റ് എല്ലാ വിദ്യാർത്ഥികൾക്കും അധ്യാപകർക്കും നന്ദി അറിയിക്കുന്നു. ഏറ്റവും അവസാനം ബട്ട് നോട്ട് ദ ലീസ്റ്റ്, ഈ പരിപാടി ഇത്തരത്തിൽ പറയുകയാണ് ആസൂത്രണം ചെയ്യുകയും പി ആർ ടി സിയുമായി ചേർന്ന് ഇത്തരത്തിലുള്ള ഒരു പരിപാടി എല്ലാവരെയും നേരത്തെ തന്നെ അറിയിച്ച് വളരെ വിജയകരമായി പ്രവർത്തിച്ചതിൻ്റെ പിന്നിലെ സൂത്രധാരൻ ഈ ഗവൺമെൻറ് ലോ കോളേജിൻ്റെ സാരഥി പ്രിൻസിപ്പൽ സി വി കുമാരൻ സാറിന് ഗവൺമെൻറ് ലോ കോളേജിൻ്റെയും എൻ്റെയും വ്യക്തിപരമായ പേരിൽ നമ്മുടെ എല്ലാവരുടെയും പേരിൽ നിസ്സീമമായ നന്ദി രേഖപ്പെടുത്തുന്നു. നന്ദി. ഞാനത് തീർക്കുന്നതിന് മുമ്പ് ദേവരാമേന്ദ്രൻ സാറടുത്ത് ഒരു രണ്ട് മൂന്ന് ഒരു സജഷൻസ് കൂടെ വെക്കാൻ ആഗ്രഹിക്കുന്നു. ഒന്ന്, സാറ് കൂടുതൽ തവണ ഗവൺമെൻറ് ലോ കോളേജ് വിസിറ്റ് ചെയ്യണം എന്നൊരു അഭ്യർത്ഥനയുണ്ട്. രണ്ട്, ഇവിടെ നിന്നുള്ള ഗവൺമെൻറ് ലോ കോളേജ് കോഴിക്കോട് നിന്നുള്ള കൂടുതൽ വിദ്യാർത്ഥികളെ സാറിൻ്റെ ഓഫീസിൽ ഇൻറ്റേൺഷിപ്പിന് സ്വീകരിക്കണം എന്ന് അഭ്യർത്ഥിക്കുന്നു. മൂന്നാമത്, ഇവിടുത്തെ സ്റ്റുഡൻസിനെ ഹൈക്കോടതിയുടെ പ്രൊസീഡിങ്സ് കാണാനും, അതായത് പഠിച്ചുകൊണ്ടിരിക്കുന്ന വിദ്യാർത്ഥികളെ തന്നെ ഹൈക്കോടതിയുടെ പ്രൊസീഡിങ്സ് കാണാനും അത് മനസ്സിലാക്കിക്കാനുമുള്ള ഒരു അവസരം സാറിൻ്റെ തന്നെ നേതൃത്വത്തിൽ ഏറ്റെടുത്തിട്ട് അതിനുള്ള ഒരു ഫെസിലിറ്റീസ് നൽകും എന്ന് പ്രതീക്ഷിക്കുന്നു. Even if they come physically, I request you to take that as a special concern, and I hope that you would offer all the help and assistance.
Also practice in the high court.
Yes.
But practice here. Come there.
But thank you so much. ഇതോടു കൂടെ എൻ്റെ എന്നിൽ അർപ്പിച്ചിരിക്കുന്ന കർത്തവ്യം ഞാൻ നിർവഹിച്ചു പൂർത്തിയാക്കുന്നു.
Thank you. Thank you so much, sir, for those gentle words from your side. As James Bond had once said, it's commitment that unlocks the doors of imagination and of vision and gives us the right stuff to turn our dreams into reality. So once again, we thank each and every one of you who have taken time out of your busy schedules to join us here today and in marking this session a great success. I hope that all of you have your day packed with knowledge, insights, excitement and exchange of ideas to be worth remembering down the years. Thank you so much, everyone. Thank you. Now I request all of you to kindly raise for the national anthem.
Please rise for the national anthem. Before that, Gayatri, you deserve a very big applaud. Gayatri, for having anchored the program. Let us all be in attention position and recite the national anthem. Start.
Janagana mana adinayaka jayahe Bharata bhagya vidata Punjab Sindh Gujarat Maratha Dravid Utkal Ganga Vindhya Himachal Yamuna Ganga Uchala Jalasidaranga Tabasubhaname Jahe Tabasubha Ashish Mage Jahe Tabajaya Gada Janagana Mangala Dayaka Jayahe Bharata Bhagya Vidata Jayahe 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 Jaya 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 He.
Thank you all once again. Please have your food. It is kept there down below. Thank you.